lots of, like the church now, Sunday mass, loads of seats at the front, no need for anybody to stand at the back. Can we close the back doors, folks? This is a session I've been looking forward to most for 6 months. This is my personal bias, was to get stuck into the nitty-gritty of the campaign. This is Tad Devine. This is Barry Donnelly. This is Colin Crowell. This is the most impressive panel ever gathered in Ireland to talk about an American election. I make no apology for making that brave statement. This is going to be a fun 2 hours. We might have another little bit of time, with the one exception, Stacy has to get a flight out of Dublin this evening, so she'll be off this stage at 5:30, no matter what happens. Which means she'll have a lot of opportunity. And she's got Republican views. She doesn't have any horns. Okay. The Irish have a compelling fascination with Donald Trump. And they have somewhat of a love affair with Hillary Clinton. But one thing they haven't had an opportunity, I think, yet to sufficiently understand is the Bernie Sanders phenomenon. I won't tell you how early, Tad Devine was here 4 years ago with us for the Kennedy Summer School. I won't tell you how early he said he would come back again in September, because that would suggest that they gave up hope on Sanders' campaign earlier than we want to reveal. But he and Alan were so anxious to come back and visit us in New Ross after the experience 4 years ago, he was happy to commit and commit early. He's been a senior strategist for Al Gore's campaign, for John Kerry's campaign, and for many years a senior strategist, writer, producer, director, particularly of television advertising, of content, of debate prep, for presidential election campaigns in America, for prime ministerial and presidential election campaigns in many parts of the world, including this country. He has been at the very center of the Bernie phenomena before it was a phenomena. It had been expected that Martin O'Malley would be the main contender against Hillary Clinton when it would come to the primary. I said to Tad yesterday when he arrived at the coffee shop below just after Martin O'Malley, whether he had met Martin O'Malley in recent years, and he said, about 3 or 4 years ago. And I said, so you haven't met him since you ran him over? He's also a conviction strategist. And therefore, we're anxious to hear why he worked with Bernie Sanders, how he worked with Bernie Sanders, and what the extraordinary story of that campaign is. Can you welcome back to the Ross, please, ladies and gentlemen, Tad Devine.
I predicted that Obama would beat Romney, and I told everyone to go to Paddy Power immediately and put the money down, okay? But I'm not going to be so bold as to make a prediction this time. But I am very pleased to talk about a campaign that I spent a year of my life on, Bernie Sanders' campaign for president. And today I want to focus on just the part of the campaign that I was most involved in, the message, the media, and the strategy. I want to try to answer the question of how Bernie Sanders came from a place where no one believed he had a chance of winning to what we call the virtual tie in Iowa, to an historic victory in New Hampshire, and to challenging Hillary Clinton seriously for the nomination, and to focus on that part of the campaign that I worked on. But if you want to understand Bernie Sanders' campaign, you really have to begin with something called the speech, okay? The speech was the speech that he gave everywhere. And the reason that Bernie got into the race for president was he spent about a year before this campaign, taking his speech on the road. Now, this is a speech I've heard him give for a long time. And I'll ask, why did you work for him? Well, I started working for Bernie Sanders in 1996, and he was very skeptical, I will tell you, about hiring a Washington political consultant. And when I was going through my notes looking for some old photos this past year, I came across a 4-page single-spaced letter that he sent me, and the gist of the letter was, listen, you don't tell me what to say, you don't tell me what to do, okay? And that's the way it was throughout his career. He is someone who has understood for a long time where he stood, whose side he was on, and the issues that he wanted to fight for. And that speech that he gave all across America, in places like Madison, Wisconsin, where you might expect him to be well received, and in places like Jackson, Mississippi, where you might be surprised to see a United States Senator. I know they weren't surprised to see a Democratic Senator. They'd never seen one before until he showed up there. And the response he got from rooms like this, from bigger audiences and smaller, convinced him that there was an appetite for what he wanted to propose, which was fundamental change in America. When you asked why did I work for him, well, when I decided to work for him, I think it would be fair to say, he was considered to be a long shot. And the Washington Post actually did a story that I was working for him, and I explained it in terms. I had worked for him for 20 years. I believed that he was a serious candidate for president. And Bernie had made a decision that he was going to announce his candidacy by the end of April. And in true Bernie Sanders style, it was April 30th. Okay, he finally came to that decision. And I had traveled to Vermont a week before and spent the weekend with just with he and his wife Jane, just basically the three of us talking about this. And I'll tell you honestly, I did not go there to make the case for him to run. I made the case about how difficult it would be to run for president, the invasion of his privacy. In order to do that, I said, I'm not even going to be here. I'm going to be on the porch over there, but I'm going to project myself into the teleprompter. We don't have any script here. We're just going to talk. Because I felt, you know, it's a lot easier to talk to a person than it is to an inanimate object, you know, just having that thing staring at you. So I put myself in the teleprompter, and I started talking to him, and we talked, and 3 hours later, I had some pretty good material of Bernie Sanders, and we began to set things up. We went to a beautiful park that's a waterfront park. It used to be an oil repository. Then the developers in Burlington tried to get the land. Bernie fought off the developers, and now it's a beautiful public space. He won that fight at the local level to turn that park into a beautiful waterfront on Lake Champlain. And lo and behold, later that day, 5,000 people, you know, came to our announcement, and we were able to create a presidential scale and presidential style event. And I think the media then took a step back and said, wait a second, what's going on here? We then went to Iowa, New Hampshire, had huge crowds, and people said, well, maybe something's happened. And I want to show you right now, it's a long piece. I've got two long pieces at the beginning and the end of my presentation. But I wanted to show it to you. It's a video I made. It's 5 minutes long. It's called Progress. And what I tried to do is take that speech, because the speech was the heart of the campaign. And by the way, when I do stuff, it's usually on the basis of polls and focus groups and research. We didn't have any. You know, there were no polls, there were no focus groups. Later we had some, but not at this juncture. There was Bernie, the speech, his story, his narrative. And I tried to put it together and to begin to tell it to people, to tell the story of who he was, where he came from, what he believed, and most importantly, what he wanted to do for our nation, his vision for America's future. So you don't have to have an hour and 15 minute Bernie Sanders stump speech. That's how long his stump speech usually lasted. I'll try to get into it all right now in 5 minutes.
Speech, I had the feeling that I was, at that particular moment, part of history. and that I'm winning my first election as Mayor of Burlington by 10 votes after a recount in an election that nobody thought we could win. I met Jane just about the time of the election. We have been together for 27 years.
As president, I will defend the station, but I will do it responsibly. As a member of Congress, I voted against the war in Iraq.
I had serious doubts about what Bush and Cheney were telling us. And if you overthrew Saddam Hussein, you could bring a massive amount of instability into that region, and that it would not be quite as easy as people like Donald Rumsfeld and others were telling us. We have got to, as a moral responsibility, provide the best quality health care to the men and women who put their lives on the line to defend us. John McCain and I put $5 billion into strengthening the VA so that any veteran who walks into a VA facility will get quality care in a timely manner. That was one of the major pieces of legislation passed in the last congressional session. I don't want to see people not go to the doctor when they're sick because they can't afford to pay the doctor's fees.
The United States must join the rest of the industrialized world and guarantee health care to all as a right.
Nothing is closer to my priority than someone who has kids besides the issue of global warming.
There is nothing more important than leaving this country and our entire planet habitable for our kids and our grandchildren.
Climate change is real. It is caused by human activity, and we have a small window opportunity to transform our energy system, cut carbon emission, and move in a very different direction.
This campaign is about putting Americans back to work at decent paying jobs.
Let's get started. Let's put $1 trillion over a 5-year period. Let's create and maintain 13 million jobs. Let's make our infrastructure stronger, safer, more efficient.
We must establish pay equity for women workers.
Bottom line is that if somebody works in this country for 40 hours a week, that person should not be living in poverty.
The issue of wealth and income inequality is the great moral issue of our time. It is the great economic issue of our time. It is the great political issue of our time. This type of rigged economy is not what America is supposed to be about. This has got to change. And as your president, together, we are going to change it.
I will be working hard with all the joint citizens, right? That is the undermining of American democracy and the qualities of this country which have made us the envy of the entire world. Today in America, we have enormous problems. They are solvable problems. This country belongs to all of us. We want to make policy that improves the lives of all of our people. That's how we transform America.
That was our message. And that message didn't change from the end of May until the California primary. Okay? He delivered it with, at times, numbing repetition, which if you're going to be heard in a nation that big, you better deliver it that way. His commitment to issues like education, universal college access, his civil rights record and commitments going back to the time he was arrested as a student at the University of Chicago, the Iraq War vote, an important point of contrast with Hillary Clinton, his success in working with John McCain and legislative achievement in a demonstration that he could do those things as president, his commitment to dealing with climate change in our time, a massive jobs program to put people back to work, and the fundamental frame of the election, that America's economy is rigged, and it's rigged by a corrupt system of campaign finance. That was the message, and that was the message that we set out and were intent to deliver. Principally through the paid media, and that's, you know, the part of the campaign that I spent most of my time on. It was critical to introducing him, particularly in Iowa and New Hampshire, where people did not know him well. Now, one of the big decisions we faced early on was in May, and I think the Clinton campaign understood that she had issues and trouble and problems in Iowa and New Hampshire, and they went on television at the beginning of August, and I remember, you know, meeting with Bernie and Jeff Weaver, the campaign manager, showing them the two fine, very good ads that Hillary's campaign had put up, two 60-second introductory biographical ads. And he said, you know, what do you want to do? We were raising money, but we had nothing compared to the money they had. And I said, listen, we can't play that game. If we play that game, it's gone. It's over for us. We're just going to have to talk to people online. You're going to have to communicate. And we've got to put this thing together and figure out how we're going to deliver it. I think we'll have enough time. And we did. We began to create a series of ads. And really, we had five basic objectives, message-wise. We wanted to tell his story. That was biographical. We wanted to seize the issue terrain of the election. That's where we believed voters were. That the economy was rigged. The rigged economy was held in place by a corrupt system of campaign finance. We knew, because by October, he actually allowed me for the first time to do some research. So I had some polls and focus groups. And I could see in Iowa, there was deep skepticism about his capacity to be president. We had to deal with that issue of presidential capacity. And then we had to begin to push off our opponent. Again, a difficult challenge from someone who said, I'll never run a negative ad. And we never ran an ad with her image or likeness or her name. And he took a lot of things off the table, as he did, for example, in the first debate when he said, I'm sick and tired of your damn emails, and refused to talk about it, or the Clinton Foundation, or other things. So, but at least, with a lot of push, frankly, from me, he was willing to take on the issue of paid speaking fees. I think not so much because of Hillary, but because of Goldman Sachs, who he really was not very fond of. And finally, you know, I felt it was very important to conclude this message frame with an affirmative, positive vision for the future. I teach at NYU, and I tell my students in every class, every winning campaign is about the future. The trick is figuring out how to get there, okay? You know, and that's why our tagline, our slogan, a future to believe in, you know, was so important to getting there. But my sort of philosophy in making television ads and delivering messages that there's some circles, concentric orbits, if you will, that we try to get within. One is authenticity, you know, having an authentic candidate, letting them speak directly to people. The second is emotion, finding emotional issues or delivering things in an emotional way. And third is telling a story. Hopefully a story that people will remember, whether it's in a 5-second ad or a 5-minute ad. And those are the three things, you know, that we try to do in every single ad. Sometimes you actually do all three. You get in that sweet spot, you know, where you're doing all those things at once. And those are the ads and the messages that I think move people. Our advertising got a lot of great feedback from commentary from the press, but me telling you that my ads were great is one thing. I'm going to instead let, there was an independent survey. They actually looked at ads from all the candidates for president early on in the process, 152 ads of Democrats and Republicans, and we did very well. As a matter of fact, seven of the top 10 ads that they tested in America were ads that we had produced for the campaign. So I feel like our paid media campaign, by the time we were done with it, we actually produced 256 ads, believe it or not, radio, television, and digital ads for this campaign. So it was a lot of work and a lot of enterprise. And I want to just take a minute to show you, I mentioned five generations of ads. I'm not going to show you all 27 ads that we ran in Iowa and New Hampshire, but I want to give you a flavor for how we worked through that media campaign. First, telling the story in biography. And then second, trying to seize that frame, the message frame of a rigged economy held in place by a corrupt system of campaign finance. We did that through a series of ads. I'll show you two of them right now. The first, the bio ad, where we told a story. The second, with an ad that we called Rigged Economy.
He's the son of a Polish immigrant who grew up in a Brooklyn tenement. He went to public schools, then college, where the work of his life began, fighting injustice and inequality, speaking truth to power. He moved to Vermont, won election and praise as one of America's best mayors. In Congress, he stood up for working families and for principle, opposing the Iraq War, supporting veterans. Now he's taking on Wall Street and a corrupt political system, funded by over a million contributions, tackling climate change to create clean energy jobs, fighting for living wages, equal pay, and tuition-free public colleges.
People are sick and tired of establishment politics, and they want real change.
Bernie Sanders, husband, father, grandfather, an honest leader, building a movement with you to give us a future to believe in.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message. It's called a rigged economy, and this is how it works. Most new wealth flows to the top 1%. It's a system held in place by corrupt politics, where Wall Street banks and billionaires buy elections. My campaign is powered by millions of small contributions. People like you who want to fight back. The truth is, you can't change a corrupt system by taking its money. I'm Bernie Sanders. I approve this message. Join us for real change.
We then moved to a third, and there were several ads in that first two generations. We then moved to a third generation of advertising where we used testimonial ads. For example, a farmer from Vermont to help to introduce Bernie to farmers in Iowa. But also to stay within the message frame at all times. We had some local ads like a Bakken pipeline, a pipeline they were trying to build in Iowa to transport energy that he opposed. And we also had to offer that reassurance that I talked about before in terms of his effectiveness and whether or not he could get things done as president. So I'll show you now two ads. The first ad is called Rock, and to tell a little side story about that, but probably the most famous ad we did, I'm going to show you in a minute, is called the America ad. We used Paul Simon's and Art Garfunkel's America as a theme, and we made an ad about it. And when I first thought we could use that, Bernie had lunch with Paul Simon. He called me up and he said, had lunch with Paul Simon. He's got a great idea. He's got a wonderful song he thinks we should use. I said, oh, what is it? He said, I am a rock. And I said, I don't think that's a good idea. He's like, why not? I said, I have my books and my poetry to protect me. I'm shielded by my armor, hiding in my room, safe within my tomb. I touch no one and no one touches me. Bernie, it's too close to the truth. Okay, we can't go there. All right, we're not going there. But I knew Paul Simon might give us a song, you know, and if you've got a socialist running for president, what better song is there than America, okay? You know, to convince people that his values are very much their values. But when we did this interview, my partner Julia Moby did it, the farmer in Vermont, and we were sitting watching the footage, and I saw what this farmer said at the end. I said, okay, we can realize Paul Simon's dream, perhaps in a different way, so.
There's a lot to do on a dairy farm. Nobody's going to do it for you. You have to get out there and do it yourself. Bernie Sanders is a well-known friend of family farms. Bernie cannot be bought out by big money. Bernie's opinion cannot be purchased. It's time for our next president to get in there, roll up his sleeves, take off the gloves, and take on Wall Street, take on big business, take on big money, and get the working class back where they should be. He's a rock.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
Praised as one of America's best mayors who governed as a pragmatist. A practical and successful legislator, Bernie Sanders passed more amendments in a Republican Congress than any other member. Primary care access for millions of Americans. Protected Social Security. Cracked the gridlock with John McCain to strengthen veterans' health care. Bernie Sanders, a consistent, principled, and effective leader. Building a future to believe in.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
So now with three of the four generations of ads through, we came to a period in early January where we really had to make that contrast more apparent. And to do so, under the ground rules that we were never going to attack our opponent. So we wanted to look closely at the role of special interests. How do special interests have so much impact in American politics? And the argument that we made was, well, listen, they're in a position to buy elections, okay? And the way they buy elections is with their money. And we made the money, both the money of buying elections by special interests, and also the fact that Bernie Sanders refused to have a super PAC, refused to engage in kind of the old politics, and was relying on small contributions, an average contribution of $27 to fund his campaign. By the way, that campaign, with an average contribution of $27, raised $243 million, okay, which allowed us to go toe-to-toe with Hillary Clinton. So I'll show you two of the ads that we ran in the States. One's called Goldman. Guess what that's about. And the other is called $27.
They're one of the Wall Street banks that triggered the financial meltdown. Goldman Sachs just settled with authorities for their part in the crisis that put 7 million out of work and millions out of their homes. How does Wall Street get away with it? Millions in campaign contributions and speaking fees. Our economy works for Wall Street because it's rigged by Wall Street, and that's the problem. As long as Washington is bought and paid for, we can't build an economy that works for people.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
$27.
I think it's the best $27 you can spend.
It's the average donation given to Bernie Sanders.
$27.
To make college tuition free.
For better care of our veterans.
For women's rights.
For health care for all.
To make Wall Street corporations pay their fair share.
To keep us out of unnecessary wars.
To ensure a living wage.
To get big money out of politics.
For the poor.
For the marginalized.
For the rich.
For all of us.
Get 27 to transform America.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
days of the Iowa campaign and the New Hampshire campaign. And by then, the America ad was done. We had this ad that not so much was about Bernie's agenda, but about the fact that his campaign represented a movement, an opportunity for people to come together behind something that they believed in. And that's what that ad was about. It was about people coming together to support him. He was drawing huge crowds, 5,000, 10,000, 25,000 people in places like Los Angeles and Seattle. And we wanted to capture that and deliver that and deliver the sense. The media went crazy with this ad. And the New York Times actually, at one point in time, ran 6 versions. I wound up making 10 versions of this ad. The last one I made to introduce Hillary Clinton at the convention and snuck a couple of scenes of him and her in there together to put Stronger Together to Build a Future to Believe in, because I thought maybe that would help, you know, grease the wheels a little bit. But we ran this ad. It had millions of views within a couple of days online. And that was a big part of our ad campaign, not just the ads that we bought on TV, but the ads that people saw online all across America. So I'll play our 2 final ads. One is the America ad. The second is called American Horizon. And I'll tell you, I filmed this ad with Bernie in New Hampshire. And he had been campaigning on the road. He was 74 years old, just turned 75 yesterday. And here was a guy out campaigning very hard for a long time. And when he came into that shoot, he was tired. He was very tired. He said, can I rest for a few minutes? He laid down on a couch for about 15 minutes. Then he came in. I had an hour of his schedule that day. And he came in and he sat with me and 2.5 hours to camera. Really strong. And he'd do a spot. He'd say, I can do better. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. And he went on. And it was incredible. And I used that film for the next 8 weeks in the campaign to make a series of spots, including this final one called American Horizon. I felt it was really important that he looked people in the eye, voters of Iowa, asked for their vote, and told them where he wanted to lead America on the basis of his platform and the issues that he cared deeply about. So here's America and American Horizon. This is the other place we delivered a lot of message. We posted web ads, we delivered them online. We had tens of millions of views. Our internet offerings range from 5-second ads to 5-minute ads, and I'll show you one of each before concluding. But remember those things that I talked about before: authenticity, emotion, storytelling. That's the way I believe you make connection with voters, and that's what we tried to do. In Iowa, if you were 18 to 29 year old, I guarantee you that on your phone, you got one of these, okay, in Iowa and New Hampshire before the election, a message trying to make sure that you knew, you know, there was a caucus on Monday night, there was a primary next Tuesday, we had some of them saying, take the folks with you, okay, and that was a great way, we want support intergenerationally. So I'll show you two of the 5-second ads that popped up everywhere the last week of the campaign, the first in Iowa, the second in New Hampshire. In the months that followed, and it gave us an unbelievable advantage, resource superiority. We didn't have a super PAC, she had one. We didn't have outside entities, she had others. So it wasn't like we had a big advantage money-wise. In the real world, we didn't have any. But we weren't being massively outspent, and we had the resources to make, I think, some good decisions. Let me just touch on a few highlights, and then I'll finish my presentation. We had a lot of big moments in the campaign. So many, it'd be hard to recall them all now, but a few that come to mind to me is Bernie Sanders went to Liberty University. It was Liberty University, a very conservative college in Virginia. It was founded by Jerry Falwell, the moral majority. His son is now the chancellor there. And, you know, for Bernie to go into Liberty and to talk to them about his values and what he believed in and why he believed the agenda that he was proposing was not only right but moral, and the right thing to do, and that income and wealth inequality was the great moral issue of our time. You know, it was just a demonstration, I think, of, you know, the belief that he had that what he was doing was right. And the respect that he got for doing it was really tremendous. Another huge moment in this campaign was when Bernie went to Georgetown University. Professor Woolner was speaking about Franklin Roosevelt before, and, you know, Bernie Sanders was, people said, what's your political philosophy? He said, I'm a democratic socialist, and he would defend it. Now, you know, that was one of the reasons for the incredible skepticism initially about his campaign. No one believed the socialist was going to be the president of the United States. But the truth is, and Bernie Sanders in this speech at Georgetown laid it out in some detail, his political philosophy, I think, was very much in sync with Franklin Roosevelt. And indeed, at this Georgetown speech, he cited the speech that President Roosevelt gave that Professor Woolner alluded to earlier today about the unfinished economic agenda in America and the need for an economic bill of rights in America, that people could have the right to work and the right to health care and the right to, you know, live a decent life economically. And that connection to Franklin Roosevelt, I think, was a very powerful one and really at the heart of Bernie Sanders, not only his message, but his agenda, an unfinished agenda that harkened back to the Great Depression. The debates were very important. We had, you know, the first one, he hated to prepare for them. We actually, his chief of staff played Hillary, and my business partner played Governor O'Malley. You can see he's almost as good looking as Governor O'Malley, but not quite. We had a lot of debates. And, you know, the debates take place on the stage, and then there's a debate before, and there's a debate after. And usually we get to be in those debates, the spin room before. And I'll tell you, I saw the power of Twitter. We're going to hear about Twitter soon, but before one of the debates, the Clinton campaign had put out their pre-bump. This is where they, you know, tell you what's, you know, going to happen in the debate and what's wrong with your opponent. And, you know, they attacked me in the pre-bump because I had said, we were involved in a dispute with the DNC, and I said one of the young staffers who had looked at Hillary Clinton's voter file had made a mistake, and they attacked me. I had said it was a mistake, it was terrible. So I decided I was going to launch, not on press person who attacked me, but Hillary, why not? You hit me, I hit her, okay? You know, that's, we'll see how that works out, right? But, so I put out a little tweet saying, you know, when I said mistake, I meant it in the mistake that Hillary Clinton, in the sense Hillary Clinton did when she said her Iraq war vote was a mistake, okay? And the next thing I knew, ABC News, which was covering the debate, put it on TV, and my phone kept going ding, 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 ding. It was all my new Twitter followers. They were coming out of nowhere. The thing was, I had hundreds of, you know, people were tweeting it. It was all over the place. And it's a great example of something, we're going to hear more about this soon. And the social media, you can move things so fast, instantaneously now, if you hit, you know, that sweet spot in the social media. We had a big dispute with the Democratic Party. We actually sued them in federal court. We were about to be granted injunctive relief about 10:30 on Friday night when they decided to settle and give us back our voter file. You know, one of the big moments of the campaign, I think, happened when Larry David decided to start playing Bernie Sanders on Saturday Night Live. And he did such an incredible impression. And we got a lot of people, I think, interested in Bernie and knowing about him. I mentioned that we had what was called a virtual tie in Iowa. And, you know, all the polls said we were going to lose Iowa. But in fact, you know, we closed the thing up. And we were watching the TV in the hotel suite. We decided we had to leave Iowa and go to New Hampshire because we needed to get to New Hampshire. And we still didn't know actually who won Iowa. You know, Bernie, one thing he did in Iowa was convince people that he cared about them. You know, cares about people like you, 74, Bernie Sanders, 22, Hillary Clinton. So, you know, we were making that case, I think, very effectively and very powerfully. And even as we went to a plane, and here's a guy who started off with nothing, and the next thing you know, we've got this big, gigantic plane. The plane was full of the press. Everybody, we let the reporters on our plane. At that time, Hillary wouldn't, so we, you know, everybody came on our plane. And, we're still trying to figure out who won Iowa, you know? And so we made that flight, and we got to New Hampshire about 4 o'clock in the morning, and then 5 o'clock in the morning, we decided to have a rally. We actually decided that evening, Jeff Weaver, my partner Mark Longabaugh, and I were sitting in a restaurant in Des Moines, and we said, you know, we gotta do something when we land there. This thing is just, you know, it's too hot, we gotta do something. So we scheduled a rally for 5 in the morning. Hundreds of people showed up, and Bernie Sanders, with the energy of a 20-year-old, hopped on the back of a pickup truck and gave a rousing speech. I think it was probably the best event that we did that entire week. I was interviewed recently by Simon Carswell of the Irish Times, and he asked me, was there ever a moment that you thought you actually might win this thing? And I had never really thought about it until he asked me that question, and I said, you know, yeah, I think there was. It's when we flew from Des Moines to Manchester, landed, and we did that event. At that one moment, I said, you know what? We might actually do this. It could be possible. You know, the New Hampshire polling got better and better, and Bernie won an historic victory in New Hampshire. He won more votes in the New Hampshire primary than any candidate in history. The previous record had been John McCain in 2000, 115,000 votes. Bernie Sanders won 150,000 votes. Al Gore, who I worked for, won a close victory. He was the incumbent vice president of the United States. He got 75,000 votes in New Hampshire. John Kerry, who was from a neighboring state, won New Hampshire with about the same amounts of votes. I worked for John. I worked for Michael Dukakis. He won the New Hampshire primary with 44,000 votes. Bernie got 150,000 votes in a Democratic primary. And you know, the speech continued. That speech that you saw at the beginning continued all the way to the end, except now he was getting noticed on the covers of magazines. We laid out a strategy post-Super Tuesday, and we pursued it all the way through California, which is basically what Bernie decided to do. After we lost Nevada, I said, listen, I don't know how we can do this. What do you want to do? He said, I want to take this message all the way through California. I said, I think we can do it. Jeff Weaver and I worked very hard to try to make that happen. And while we didn't succeed in winning, I think we succeeded in moving the Democratic Party to where, much closer to where he wanted to be, a progressive force in politics in America and the world. I'm going to conclude by showing you one last video. It's one I'm very proud of. It's a video that was made about workers in Florida in a place called Immokalee. Bernie Sanders went there. He was on a congressional trip. And, you know, unlike I think probably a lot of the people who were on that trip, he decided he wasn't going to spend the afternoon at the pool. Bernie, being Bernie, said, I'd like to visit these workers. I've heard about them. They have a lot of problems. So he went there and he listened to their stories. And he was inspired to take action by it. And of course, at that time, he was in the United States Senate. And he was on a committee that was chaired by the single best politician I've ever met in my life, Senator Edward Kennedy. I had the privilege of working for him in 1994 in a tough campaign against Mitt Romney for the United States Senate seat in Massachusetts. And Senator Kennedy, being the guy that he was, heard the story from Bernie, said, you know what, Bernie, we're going to have a committee hearing, and I'm going to let you chair it. And he did. Bernie chaired the hearing at Senator Kennedy's behest, and they showed a bright spotlight on what was happening to these exploited workers in Immokalee. And we went down and interviewed a woman who lived and worked there, who told her story, and that story allowed us to tell the story about Bernie Sanders' commitment to equal justice, to economic equality, and to standing up for people. It's really was one of many, many, many videos like this. We found so many incredible people all across America who had unbelievable stories, authentic, emotional, and a vehicle to tell a story that hopefully people will remember. This ad was historic in many ways. We put it on Univision in prime time, 8:48 p.m. The week before Super Tuesday, so it was seen nationally. We also spot bought it in some big markets with large Latino populations across the country. It's in Spanish with English subtitles, English with Spanish subtitles when Bernie speaks. But I think you get a good sense of why Bernie Sanders' message resonated so powerfully, particularly online, with young people who saw things like this and who believed that this was somebody who they could believe in. So this is, we all have families.
Yo creo que siempre voy a luchar mientras yo vea a mis hijos felices y que ellos estén bien. Voy a seguir luchando por ellos para darles lo mejor. Pues mis hijos son como el motor de mi vida que le da. Mi familia aquí son mis tres niños. Aquí en Mogali, Florida. Y Mogali es un pueblo pequeño, pero está lleno de gente muy trabajadora y también muy amable. Es un pueblo muy bonito, en medio de todo lo que hay, lo que ha habido en el trabajo, abusos en el campo. Cuando vine de México, empecé a trabajar en el campo. Bueno, los tomates que yo pisco son los que se usan como en ensaladas, como así, americanas. Había más abusos de los patrones hacia sus trabajadores, o de que no les proveían lo necesario, como agua o los baños. Los patrones se enojaban de que si ya no querían seguir trabajando, hasta se agarraban a golpes. Solamente en las noches a veces uno se pone como a veces hasta llorar porque no le alcanza. También a los niños les afecta porque a veces no alcanzaba para todo lo que era como la comida. No saben por todo lo que uno tiene que pasar, porque tenemos familias. Y yo empecé a participar como a las protestas para comida por comida justa, fue en el 2010. Comida Justa está pidiendo que las grandes corporaciones paguen como un centavo más por libra de tomate para que así también les llegara a los trabajadores lo que es justo. Empecé a participar porque me pareció que es bueno que haya personas que se preocupan por mejorar las condiciones de trabajo, porque es ahí donde menos se preocupa en la gente.
In January of 2008, I went to Immokalee. What I discovered was a human tragedy. Workers were being paid starvation wages and subjected to abusive labor practices.
Bernie Sanders se interesó en la vida de los trabajadores y quiso saber de las luchas. Políticos que muchas veces nunca llegan aquí a Immokalee. Él no solo se quedó con lo que vio aquí en Immokalee.
We heard the voices of Immokalee, workers who were at the lowest rung of the economic ladder, workers who had no rights.
Se fue a Washington e hizo una junta con los senadores, se puede decir, para que conocieran lo que se vive aquí en Immokalee y si hay más derechos y más apoyo como a los trabajadores. Se empezó a ver como los cambios en el pago, si fue algo mejor. Ya tenía para comprarle cositas a los niños. Y pues si eso cambia a la persona.
But how many more Immokalees are there? How many fields or factories are there? We have to ask ourselves, who benefits from this exploitation? And to understand that that it is not only the Immokalee workers who suffer, but every worker in America, because that pushes us into a race to the bottom.
That's our story. I still get choked up sometimes, you know, when I see these, you know, see people like Mandela. You know, it was a great campaign, a great opportunity to meet so many people all across America, and to hopefully give them hope and voice. And I think that's what Bernie did more than anything else. And while we didn't make it, I think the fact that he demonstrated that you don't have to rely on huge amounts of special interest money to fund a multi-$100 million campaign in America is the harbinger, is the pathway forward. And I'm sure that path is going to be followed by someone else in the future. And I believe you know, his candidacy and campaign made a huge difference in the life of our nation. So thank you very much.
Told about how I had run and lost an election in 1997. Radical scientist Michael Marsh said, "You didn't lose. You were just less favored than the other." So Bernie Sanders was less favored. I did decide 50 years ago I would never run for politics again. I've now decided I'd never run for politics again. I said, "Persuade Tad Devine." We're conflicted in your ask now, Tad, because that kind of politics should succeed. We're hoping your candidate in 4 years' time is knocked out before the second week of September in 2020, so we can have you back again. Thank you for traveling. One of the great things we get to do occasionally, those of us that are fans of Kennedy, is hear that lovely, soft Boston accent talk about politics. Bob Morrow this morning, it was the first of four Boston accents we're going to hear. You're now going to hear three of them in a row. The first of those is a very familiar voice to our Irish audience. He's a law lecturer and director of clinical training at University College Galway. We know him nationally as our top expert on American elections. And he's going to take us through some of the mechanics of the Electoral College and how Trump Williams. Ladies and gentlemen, Larry
Donnelly. Thanks very much, Noel. I can't resist but add one thing to Tad's just extraordinary presentation. And I think one of the things that Bernie Sanders did, and this is no mean feat, is the fact that he has made socialism less of a dirty word than it once was in United Pilots. And that's an extraordinary achievement. Okay, I've been assigned the task of outlining shock horror, I suppose, how Trump could win. And you can see I've hedged my bets slightly in the sense that I'm saying could have won, and with a question mark, and some thoughts on the future of American politics after this year's election. And I think this year's election is going to have, it already has had a big impact on the future of American politics, but I think it's a reflection of America that's changed and America that's in a difficult time. And I know Americans are known for our optimism and our can-do spirit, et cetera, and I think Francis Fitzgerald spoke eloquently to that yesterday. But at the moment, I wouldn't say optimism is the ascendant emotion in the United States. So people say to me all the time, how could this happen? How has Trump risen? What's behind all of this? You know, in the United States, it just doesn't seem that somebody who's talking about these things and saying the things he said, how could he be in position to potentially be the next president of the United States? Well, and here's where I think some of what Francis Fitzgerald said yesterday, I'm afraid, isn't true at the moment in the United States. The fact is, the vast majority of Americans think that the country is on the wrong track. Okay? The vast majority of Americans think the country is on the wrong track. Only 18% think the country is headed in the right direction. That's pretty scary for the nation of optimism, for the nation of hope. It's a pretty scary moment in time. And I suppose to double down on that a little bit, you know, we talk about young people and obviously the future hopes and dreams of their generation. Almost half of Americans under 30 think the American dream is dead. That's pretty scary stuff. And when it comes to politics, just as a brief aside, when it comes to politics, that sentiment is manifesting itself in politics. And I would never accuse President Obama of giving a bad speech because the man is incapable of giving a bad speech. But at the Democratic National Convention this year, I couldn't help but think his address, which was very hopeful and very optimistic and positive for the future, from a political point of view, I just couldn't imagine it resonating with the unemployed steelworker in Ohio or Pennsylvania. And again, I think it's just indicative of the difficult point in time that we're currently at. This has led to a number of things, but one of those, I think, is a real surge in Americans thinking inwardly, okay, or looking primarily within the boundaries of the United States. And again, this statistic that I've given you, the Pew Research poll in December 2013, you know, this is a high that hasn't been seen in decades. 80% of Americans think we shouldn't think in international terms. We shouldn't think in international terms. We should concentrate on what's happening here at home. This broader context, to me at least, explains to some extent why somebody like Donald Trump was able to capture the Republican presidential nomination. Now the political context for the rise of Trump, people now kind of forget this, but the Republican field was huge. There were 17 candidates. And when I say well-qualified, I mean these are people who held serious elective office, governors, senators, and people who had been elected to something. I think, again, just one point to make, it's kind of telling that two of the people, Donald Trump and Ben Carson, two of the people who at least in the early days were atop the field, were people without any experience of elected office whatsoever. The other point to make is at one time, I thought I might be here this year talking about Jeb Bush, the Republican nominee. And indeed, all the speculation back then was that Jeb Bush would be the nominee. As a quick aside, I suppose a lot of Americans living overseas wondered what people would say about us, the fact that we're nominating again Clinton and Bush, and we worried about what that might say about American democracy. I think Americans living overseas probably might have a little bit different take on that now. But the reason the field was so big was because the insiders knew that Jeb Bush, was a weak candidate who hadn't won an election since 2002, and they were all there saying, I'm the one who's going to pick up the pieces when Bush folds. But what they did was collectively, they grossly underestimated just how much fear and anger there was within the Republican primary electorate. And indeed, which Trump manipulated very, very skillfully throughout the campaign. And indeed, there was a lot of talk about the Tea Party movement, not so much anymore. And there's a lot of talk now that the Republican, you know, the party leadership, et cetera, has a lot to do with the rise of Trump. The conditions they created Trump, in a sense, and that he's a product of the Tea Party. I have a couple of conflicting thoughts about that. I don't think the Republican Party establishment or leadership wanted somebody who's so totally off the reservation in terms of issues like trade and military interventionism, et cetera. I'm not so sure that that's what they wanted, or even that the conditions that were there created that. The other point is about the Tea Party, which again, we don't hear much about now, but a year or two ago was all the rage, and where the Tea Party is on the spectrum. And I'll talk a little bit more about that, but the ideological idea of the Tea Party is this kind of no government, et cetera. Of course, there are aspects of this, but no government, really fierce right-wing ideological movement. I'm not so sure that's true. And again, I think that the Trump rise kind of manifests what I'm saying. But again, it's clear there's a disconnect between the leadership and the establishment and the grassroots. Donald Trump wouldn't be the nominee if there wasn't a manifest disconnect behind it. And again, this idea of conventional wisdom, one of the things that Trump has been great at is proving a lot of us who are trying to subscribe to conventional wisdom to varying degrees, is proving us completely wrong, myself included. I would have been one of the people who said that Trump would have a real problem in the primaries with the evangelicals, because here's a guy who'd been married three times, who once declared himself absolutely pro-choice. This guy said, when they can pick people like Ted Cruz, the evangelicals ultimately aren't going to go for Trump. He's going to have a real issue, especially in the South. Well, fact is, he ran very well with the evangelicals, proved us wrong. And again, this idea of personality politics, Trump's large and life persona, love him or loathe him, was definitely a factor. And again, he was a reality TV star. Those of us at the outset who said, maybe he's doing okay in the polls, but he's, you know, people know him, he was on The Apprentice, people know who he is, this will all fade. Well, he kept going. I think it says something about personality politics, and again, this kind of reality TV era that he was able to sustain that. And now, I think other speakers have alluded to this, now the Hillary factor. You know, one of the reasons why Bernie Sanders, among many reasons why Bernie Sanders ran such a strong campaign, was because a lot of Democrats just have problems with Hillary Clinton. Okay? More than two-thirds of the people don't like her, they don't trust her. Okay? These are things that she, unfortunately, to this day, in my view, still hasn't done enough to mitigate and needs to mitigate rapidly before the 8th of November. Now, how Trump could, and again you can see, like I suppose any good lawyer, I'm kind of hedging my bets here a little bit and not saying things in absolute terms. There was a moment in time, in my view, okay, after his speech at the Republican National Convention. Now, Democrats and those on the political left are going to say his speech at the convention was divisive, it was dark rhetoric, it was all the worst things about him. And maybe there's a point to that. However, in my view, it was a terrific political speech. It was a speech that appealed very strongly exactly to the audience that he needs and that he needs to get out and vote for him on the 8th of November. It struck all the right notes, and there was none of the ad-libbing and over-the-top inflammatory rhetoric that we've seen him use at so many other points. If he had followed that up, okay, by stressing the fact that he's the anti-politician, people in the United States, one of the things they like about him, I've heard countless people say, some of them my friends, unfortunately, say to me, at least he says what he thinks. Okay? There's no blow drive, there's no micromanagement. People aren't telling him what to say, and he listens and goes out and says it. He's different. He's not a politician. That's something that stands to him. It's something that works, whether people like it or not. And I think if that had been coupled with some subtle rhetorical shifts. Okay? For instance, you know, we talk about reticent Republicans. There's a lot of Republicans in the establishment who don't like Trump, who said they're not going to vote for him. If after the convention, it needed to be 8 months, and again, he still has time to do this, he'd start talking, not necessarily to say, I'm against all trade deals, okay, but saying, I'm going to pursue fair trade. And not to say, well, we're not going to go around the world fighting, we're not going to help allies, etc., but saying, I believe that there's a role for military intervention, but only when America's vital interests are at stake. If that had been coupled with some genuine appeal to groups he has serious issues with, like women, like minorities, like immigrants, again, on the immigrant issue, people have asked me, how could he possibly do this? If he had said things like going to communities, and especially in the Hispanic area, the Hispanic communities, the Hispanic neighborhoods, and saying, I really like the small businesses, the things you've built up here, these are great, these are the kind of people I want in the United States. Again, inherent in that is driving a wedge. It's saying that some of you I like, some of you I want out of here. But still at the same time, there was a potential there to build something of a small base in those communities. Again, Trump can't disown who he is. Okay? Can't disown who he is. And whether people here in Ireland find it cringe worthy or not, I know lots of people do, this idea of make America great again, okay, it's a great political slogan. People can read into that exactly what they want, and some people, of course, will read negative things and things we might find abhorrent into it, But at the same time, this idea of make America great again, bring it, for a lot of people that recalls a time when things were simpler, when things were easier, when they had a better life, when they had more things going for them. Okay? That vast sway, that undefinable entity called Middle America, this speaks directly to them. And again, it's ambiguous enough that each person can read into it what he or she wants. And this idea of America first, and I think Pat Buchanan, who spotted a lot of the trends that the president ran for president 3 times, who spotted a lot of the stuff that Trump spotted, he originally coined this slogan of America first. It's a winning one again in the sense that so many Americans are worried about their own country, their own affairs, they're looking inward. Put this country first, never mind everybody else. And this idea of smart negative, not these deeply personal, some of the deeply personal attacks, coming down to people's looks and their appearance and all that sort of thing, things that really backfire with a lot of different groups, most particularly, I think, with women. If you've gone smart, you're going to get the issue of emails. The Clinton Foundation, which, by the way, I think actually is more politically could be more politically damaging than the emails, because I think a lot of Americans shut off when they start hearing email service. If you stick on that message, I think that would be strong. But the biggest failing of the Trump campaign, and again, when we study political campaigns, to some extent, you have to give Trump credit. He won the Republican nomination when nobody thought he could. But his biggest failing is, in the end of the day, the guy just doesn't seem to realize that there's a difference between winning the Republican nomination and winning an election, okay, when all Americans have a say, and when their collective complexion is different. Okay? When there's a lot more women, when the demographics are 100% different. I think we saw an example of that recently when he went down to Mexico and tried to appear presidential in the meeting afterwards. We said, our countries are friends, etc. Now, I know there were differing accounts of what happened at the meeting, but there was a different bearing to what he said. And then the same evening, he comes back and doubles down on the really harsh anti-immigrant rhetoric. It's not going to win him any friends. It might make his base smile, but it's not going to expand the coalition he needs to win the presidency. In terms of the path, and this is what it's all about, is where's the path to victory? We're having, I suppose, two discussions in parallel. And I have to say, these factors I'm going to talk about in a minute, they're all perfectly valid. But I do get a little bit annoyed. When I keep hearing people talk about things, I say, okay, show me how he's going to win. Okay? But the fact is, and it makes a lot of commentators a little bit reticent, a little bit gun-shy. Okay? Trump did it once. Larry, you said Trump couldn't win. Okay? He won now, and now you're saying he surprised us once, he could do it again. That's perfectly valid. Okay? We've seen the polls tighten a little bit. Okay? I think there's an undeniable tightening in recent days. I don't think it's as drastic. Some of these national polls, I think, are a little bit misleading. And this tightening is happening despite the fact that after the Republican convention, he made a series of terrible mistakes, including, I think most particularly, going after the family of an American serviceman who was killed. A terrible mistake. But still, the numbers have tightened. I think there's a general skepticism about polls. I think that's probably warranted, especially given we saw the Brexit vote. And this idea of a silent Trump vote, I know at least one other speaker has mentioned that. Here's one where I'm personally a little bit gun-shy, having written 2 columns in the context of the marriage referendum last year, which I, based on no more than my own supposition, and I suppose a little bit of instinct, thought that there might be as much as 10% of a silent vote in the marriage equality referendum, and I was proven dead wrong. So I'm a little bit wary of the silent Trump. There might be a bit of that, but I don't think it's going to be a huge factor. The other factor is, I suppose, this new climate. The populist, anti-globalist right, and I should have right in inverted commas because I'm not so sure it's ideologically pure right in the Western world, this idea of a new climate. Okay, so all of this kind of maelstrom of things that seem to set the stage for a Trump victory. At the same time, I know this is, some of the Clinton people are saying this, and that's, it's the Electoral College. And this is why I say brass tacks, okay? Getting down to brass tacks and saying, okay, you think Trump is doing well, but how is he going to do it? And he, people say to me, he fooled me once, so America's different now. There's going to be something here. Trump is going to do it. I bet he's going to do it. And I keep saying, how? Show me the path to victory. Okay? And that path to victory is through the Electoral College. That's the way American presidential elections work. And I think some of us who are close to the process, we make the mistake of assuming that everybody is familiar with the Electoral College and knows how it works. Okay? I think people outside the US in particular look at it with this kind of mix of incomprehension and, I think, profound suspicion, especially since 2000, the Bush versus Gore election. But the Electoral College, 50 states, plus the District of Columbia, Washington, D.C., and the winner takes all, okay? So you win, if you win by one vote, or you win by a million votes, you win the state, and you win all of that state's Electoral College votes, except for Nebraska and Maine. The Electoral College vote equals the total number of senators and congressmen, of senators and members of the House of Representatives that each state sends to Washington. So, as such, in California, 39 million people. There's two US senators, 53 members of the House of Representatives, 55 Electoral College votes. You win California by one vote, you get all 55 Electoral College votes. Wyoming, just over 500,000 people, two US senators, one member of the House of Representatives. Okay. That makes for 568 total votes, and you need 270 to win. Okay. So that's the dynamic, and okay. That's how this all works. And indeed, there's lots of debates about the Electoral College, whether it's a good thing or a bad thing. I happen to think it has, by and large, been a good thing for America, for the United States. Others take a different view. That all said, if we look at Trump's path, and we try to analyze Trump's path, it's very narrow. If we were to look at the Electoral College map from 2012, and we look at all the states that Romney won and all the states that President Obama won, we can see the map is difficult for Trump. The maths, the Electoral College maths, are very difficult. To my way of looking at the numbers, and again, I referenced the website here, 270towin.com. There are a number of different ones where you can put yourself, your ideas and your thoughts about whether Trump can win this thing to the test. When you do it, you're probably going to find that Trump is going to need to win Florida, Ohio, and Pennsylvania in order to pull this thing off. There are other combinations that some mooted. I find them very unlikely, and I also find them unlikely given that there is at least some people are saying, I tend to think this won't happen, some people are saying that Hillary Clinton could win Georgia or could win Utah. There was a recent poll that says that she's neck and neck with Trump in Texas. I could be proven wrong, but I don't think Hillary Clinton's going to win Texas. So Trump needs to win Florida, Ohio, and Pennsylvania. That is a very, very big ask. Pennsylvania, the aggregates have Trump down by about 8 points consistently, and Hillary Clinton on the poll aggregates is ahead in Florida and Ohio. So I should also note that Pennsylvania hasn't gone for a Republican candidate since 1988. Okay. So it's a very, very tall order, a very, very difficult task for him to get there. Could he do it? Yes, he could. But I just think people should be under no illusions that his path to victory is a very, very narrow one. And the recent polls don't change that. Okay, the future, whether Trump wins or loses. And again, I think he has a chance. I think there's a path. I don't think he'll win. But, and here's where the impact of the election might be felt. Republicans are party divided. I think a lot has been made about that before Trump's rise. It's probably even more divided now because it's not just this kind of divide between the hard right and what people here might term more sensible Republicans. Now it's infinitely more complicated because of the Trump vote and the clear fact that despite what might have been regarded as profound ideological differences with the conservative philosophy, Trump still has real appeal with grassroots Republicans. So now we have a party with so-called mainstream economic and social conservatives. Again, these people would generally be further to the right of Ronald Reagan, but now they've become mainstream social and economic conservatives. The ever-shrinking band of moderate Republicans, the hard right, Okay, the ideological hard right, okay, whether it's on social issues or on economic issues. And then, and I put a question mark after it, and then the Trump backers. Okay. Are they in this coalition now too? Despite, again, what I would suspect are some serious differences, especially about the role of government and government programs, etc. Are they there? Okay. And it leaves the question, where exactly is the American political right now? It's an open question. Democratic Party, okay, is a different party than it once was. There's no doubt about it. Okay. If you look at where it's safe, okay, where the safe places are, okay, and who are the likely Democratic voters, again, a lot of these would be affluent, okay, well-educated, social liberals on the coast, places like Massachusetts, California. Okay. Also, obviously, different groups. Okay, Democrats have championed the interests, okay, of historically oppressed groups in different constituencies in the United States. African Americans, Hispanics, recent immigrants, okay, those are the core elements of the Democratic coalition. But, and this is the problem, what about the white working class? The people who historically, a lot of these are ethnic Catholics, were the backbone of the Democratic Party. The party has a real problem with these voters. A real problem. So, the status quo, as I say, is there are defined geographic areas of strength. Republicans are strong in the South, the Midwest. Democrats are strong on the coast, the upper Midwest. Democrats have an advantage with respect to the presidency because of the high turnout of young people, of minorities. And in most of the heavily populated states, they have an advantage. Republicans, okay, the geographic areas, but they're strong in the House. Okay, there's almost no chance they're going to lose control of the U.S. House. And also at state level, okay, they control a solid majority of governorships, solid majority of state legislatures. But for both parties, both of which pride themselves on being big tents, the tents aren't big enough. Okay? The tents aren't big enough to build a coalition into which one or the other would be the dominant political party in the United States. Okay? So, both parties have real appeal deficits. Okay? They have appeal deficits, and they have serious challenges, okay, as a result. Okay? Republicans, what will they do? Republicans could adopt some of the stuff that Trump has been saying. They could say, adopt a more skeptical approach on trade. They could say, we're not going to be as adventurous with respect to military usage as, for instance, John McCain would have them. Okay? They could tone it down. But the issue becomes the party of the Chamber of Commerce, the party of economic interests, the party of wealthy people. How might that go down? Okay? Upper middle class whites. Okay? Again, one of the stories of this election is Mitt Romney won college-educated whites big time. Donald Trump is having a real problem with them. Okay, would moving a little bit on the spectrum hurt them with those groups? Okay? Not to mention compounding the pre-existing difficulties with immigrants and women, with African Americans, etc. Democrats, on the other hand, could partly try to go back to their roots and be more of a labor party or a labor-oriented party and say, look, we're not going to reflexively back trade deals. Okay? We're going to oppose military interventionism, despite the past votes and the past rhetoric of Hillary Clinton. And they could say, yes, we still stand for, as they would call it, the right thing, and for women's rights, et cetera, on social issues, but they could make that an adjunct, not something they put front and center. But that might alienate voters as well, and the key groups that they need. So, in this kind of complicated, and I apologize if this sounds a little bit incoherent, because it's tough to be coherent about something that is slightly incoherent. There are potentially significant, as I put it, fork in the road choices for both parties. I tend to think they're not going to make them in a pronounced way. They'll probably continue to amble along as they are, by and large. But what I will say is that after this election, and I'm using Trump's terms, he recently gave a speech on Americanism versus globalism. That's his way of putting it. But I suspect that in future, at least in the near future, American politics is going to be defined, and the split in American politics is going to be defined every bit as much by how a candidate or how a party views America and its role in the world, okay, as it will be by traditional left and right labels. There are interesting times ahead, both in the next few months and in the years to come. So stay tuned. Thanks. Has its international headquarters, but also enjoying some family entanglements, or as we would say on the other side of the Atlantic, visiting with the cousins. And I've certainly enjoyed the time here. But I've heard about the Kennedy Summer School for several years now, so I'm tickled pink to finally have an opportunity to also come down here to New Ross and be with you today. What I'm going to do is talk a little bit about Twitter in the context of the election that we're having in the United States. A lot of what I'm going to say is also true for other social media platforms, for Facebook, for Instagram, Snapchat. I'm going to focus particularly on Twitter, one, because I work for Twitter, but secondly, because it does play a particularly pronounced role in the campaigns this year, and does have a role with respect to the use by campaigns and journalists in particular who cover those campaigns that I think is unique among social media platforms. And the reality is that Twitter has been part of the election cycles and the election environment almost since its inception. So Twitter was born in March of 2006 as a service, and the first presidential election that came up in the States was 2008. That was the election where President Obama obviously prevailed, but there was a very lengthy and riveting primary battle between President Obama and Hillary Clinton during the spring into the summer of 2008. And one of the reasons that President Obama prevailed, one of the reasons people attribute his victory in the primaries over Hillary Clinton, in part, was his campaign's more adept use of social media, its earlier adoption of social media, and its ability to reach voters, particularly the youth vote, in the primary campaign. And I remember on election day in 2008, and I was watching the returns on television, and we had just started this phenomenon of watching things on TV, but then checking your social media feeds at the time. And I remember all of the tweets as then-President-elect Obama brought his family out onto the stage in Soldier's Field in Chicago, and the crowd celebrating the victory, but also celebrating the fact that we had elected the first African-American in our history as President of the United States. And the voluminous amount of tweets and that day was sort of etched in my mind. But the reality is now, 8 years later, in 2016, if you took all of the tweets in the 24 hours of election day in 2008, that would represent just 6 minutes of traffic on Twitter today. So the Twitter platform serves 500 million tweets a day. So that's a billion tweets every 2 days. So the amount of content is voluminous, and so the rapidity and the overwhelmingly public nature of that content is what drives a lot of campaign use, but also a lot of coverage of the candidates and the political parties. So what I'm going to show you here is just a series of very simple slides with some Twitter data, showcasing some Twitter moments from our mid-year political conventions with the Republicans in Cleveland and the Democrats in Philadelphia, just to give you a sense at a high level of some of the content and how that was played there. I can describe the slides, but okay, super, thanks so much. Okay, so this is effective as of the end of August, 275 million tweets about Trump, positive or negative, 146 million tweets about Clinton, again, just in the aggregate, what we see there. 47 million tweets about the Republican and Democratic parties during the course of the campaign. 13 billion impressions. So impressions are essentially every time a tweet is served into a Twitter timeline. Now here are the top tweeted moments at the Republican convention. First is Trump, nobody knows the political system better than me, which is why I alone can fix it. The crowd reacts as Donald Trump arrives at the conclusion of Ted Cruz's speech. And that was at a moment where Cruz was addressing the convention and not mentioning Trump's name, which was really irksome to the Trump supporters. And Donald Trump almost preemptively entered the hall and drew some of the attention away from Cruz as Senator Cruz was completing his remarks. And then the third most tweeted moment was when Trump's spouse, Melania, indicated in her remarks that he represented all the people, not just some of the people. The most tweeted tweet, individual tweet, was Donald Trump's. The media is spending more time doing a forensic analysis of Melania's speech than the FBI spent on Hillary's emails. So that's red meat, obviously, for lots of Trump supporters. These are the ones that we had here just afterwards in Philadelphia with the Democrats. Let's get to work as First Lady Michelle Obama finishes her speech. The president impromptu to the audience booing the first reference to Trump's name in his oration. Don't boo, a lot of traffic. And then the one that hits particularly home for Twitter, Hillary Clinton stipulating that a man you can bait with a tweet is not a man we can trust with nuclear weapons. And so those were the top moments at the Democratic convention. The most retweeted tweet came from the president, reflecting the wonderful remarks that I think most commentators gave to the First Lady's address at the convention. So one of the things that I want to give you in the context of what I just showed you is just understanding how social media is fitting into the campaigns this year. So first, you have to think of how the campaigns are stacking up, looking at the normal metrics that you would look at to assess the health of a campaign.
And so if you look at that, what you find is the following. So Politico reported that Trump has 84 paid staff on payroll nationally. Hillary Clinton has 703. PBS reported that Trump has 90 field offices in the top 15 battleground states. So the battleground states are, pursuant to the Electoral College that you just heard about, the battleground states are the ones that are most in contention and the most valuable, therefore, to deploy a lot of your resources to make sure you get them up on the board in your win column as opposed to your opponent. So again, Trump has 90 field offices in the top 15 battleground states. Hillary Clinton has 291. According to Open Secrets, according to Open Secrets, which is a website, opensecrets.org, where you can go and see political campaigns, campaign fundraising and spending, and ABC News, Clinton has raised, till the end of August, $314 million. $314 million. Trump has raised $7.3 million. 314 to 7.3. Clinton has spent $84 million on paid advertising. Trump has spent $9 million on paid advertising. So, as Tad will tell you, as a political operative or a political junkie, if you looked at the normal metrics for assessing the health of a campaign going into the final stretch here, there's a real disequilibrium between how they stack up. So, how is it possible that Trump is defying gravity here? So there's a couple of reasons for that in general. One is that Trump has been a very adept and sophisticated utilizer of what we refer to as free media. So he spent many years on primetime television, on The Apprentice, where millions of Americans tuned in to see him every week in primetime, playing the part of a successful CEO in a reality TV show. So he has a skill set with respect to real estate, but he also acquired a skill set with respect to what you need to do to help drive ratings in a reality TV show. So he is as much of a professional celebrity as he is a real estate executive. And that colors his use of social media. Donald Trump has had a Twitter account since 2009. And what we see when you look at his Twitter account is that he started, on the day he announced, he had 2.8 million Twitter followers. Today he has 11.4 million Twitter followers. So that's a 313% increase. Hillary Clinton has also gained 5.7 million Twitter followers, and she has 8.69 million Twitter followers today. But when Donald Trump tweets in the morning, it has a very high likelihood of driving the news cycle. He can put out a tweet, and depending on what it says, depending on how provocative it may be, it has a chance of going almost instantly viral. If he begins the morning by attacking cable news hosts, as he did recently, that can drive coverage during the course of the day. So what he was doing as he does this during the primaries is he was denying oxygen to the other candidates, because he was able to get into the space, get people talking about what he wanted to talk about. And he was also being very aggressive in his rebuttals to things on Twitter. Now, whether you agreed with what he said or not, the fact is that it was driving a lot of the coverage. And people then were worked up about what he was saying. And it was very difficult for other candidates to kind of get their messages. And you almost saw the growing frustration by the other Republican candidates during the primaries at the debates, where they were increasingly trying to figure out how they could get attention. And that's the nature of his use of social media. When Hillary Clinton's campaign sends out a tweet, it is perfectly rendered, has proper grammar, no misspellings. It effectively delivers the very short message. It can include their campaign videos. As Ted said, you're trying to reach lots of voters. It's a very open, public way to reach people quickly. You can rebut people very quickly as well. When Donald Trump tweets, it might be very provocative. The grammar may not be perfect. He might have a typo or two. But for his supporters, what that shows and what that means to them is that was actually Donald Trump tweeting. He's speaking directly to them. And one of the things that works best on Twitter is the authentic nature of the voice that you bring to it. And so as Tad mentioned earlier, you know, the simple formula of authenticity, emotion, and telling a story is something that you can bring very quickly to the Twitter platform. And Donald Trump brings a very authentic and unique voice. He speaks very clearly and directly. One of the reasons why Bernie Sanders' campaign did very well, and did particularly well with youth, was because of the very direct use of language. It's a corrupt political system. The economy is rigged, okay? Very direct. And that is what a lot of the youth are responding to, because they feel that, they see that. And so in many respects, their use of Twitter brings a directness and an authenticity, but an instantaneous quality to what's there. The other use of Twitter in the campaign is around data. So political campaigns are now voracious consumers of data and analytics. And with a platform that has 500 million tweets a day, we obviously have lots of data. And so when we work with campaigns, we also are in a situation where they can see the data that would be overwhelmingly public for others to see, but aggregating it and slicing and dicing it in a way to find some insights is what the campaigns are trying to figure out so that their next pitch hits home. And so looking at that, I think in the future you're going to see ever more investigative types of analysis of what the data is showing in response to all these tweets that are going out from the different candidates and the campaigns. But it is also that Twitter data is also increasingly getting noticed and utilization for things like political polling. So one of the things that has confounded political pollsters over the last several years is that young people don't have landline phones. And so the traditional way of doing a telephone poll, where you'd have the lists that you could call, were typically driven to landline phones. And so as each year goes by, more and more young people, they don't, when they get their apartment and they get their place to stay, they're not really signing up and getting a phone, a landline phone with it. They just keep their mobile phone. Those mobile phones often don't find themselves on these lists that the pollsters can call. So you're a little skewed. Twitter was able to pick up the rise just before the Iowa caucuses of Ted Cruz. You could see it on Twitter, you could see it with the number of people mentioning Cruz, and that was definitely picked up in the Twitter data. You could see him moving in those final days. The same was true of John Kasich in New Hampshire. You saw an upswing in Twitter mentions, and that Twitter data indicated some movement there. This is faster than normal polling would be, where you might have to call over two, three, four nights. You can see this in real time on the platform. Now, admittedly, the Twitter polling would be somewhat skewed because you're also looking at the demographic of who is on Twitter. So depending on the geographic location, it might skew that way. But I think more and more political analysts and certainly academics are looking at that kind of data as a proxy, a better proxy than some other polls. Because at the end of the day, the other way Campaigns often try to assess the impact of messages is with focus groups. This is a live focus group at scale, and you can get real-time data coming back in on how certain messages are playing, and then tack to the wind depending on how those messages play out. So I'm going to pause there just to make sure we have ample time for questions, but thank you for listening.
Behavior change communications with NGOs and others in many countries. At a very busy time in that work in her life, she's taken 24 hours to be with us in New Ross. She has worked on Mitt Romney's campaign, she's worked on George W. Bush's campaign, she's been a former vice chair of Republicans Abroad UK, but she now chairs a cross-party, bipartisan pact of Fraser Action Committee called American Voices Abroad. Because she's taken the time out, I'm not going to be responsible for her not getting her plane this evening. She's going to speak. I'm actually going to take some questions then from the audience for Stacey and let her go. And then Kevin will please speak. Can you please give a special New Ross welcome?
I was starting to think it was a bit of a stitch up that I wasn't going to get to speak. So. Right, I'll try to make this quick. And bear with me if I speak very fast. My grandmother always said she never knew where I came from, being from the South. We tend to be a little bit slower at home. So just very quickly, a bit about me is, as Noel said, I'm not a professional politician, I'm not a historian, I'm not an academic. I'm here in very much a volunteer capacity. I've worked as vice chairman of Republicans Abroad in the UK, but my day job is very different working in international development in developing countries with governments and aid agencies doing lots of different things. And something that has really stood out to me in my work is whether it's Tanzania, it's Nigeria, wherever it may be, from the taxi driver to the minister, there is something that is happening across the globe. There is a frustration of the middle class, there's a frustration of those who have not been able to get the education that they want. There is frustration of those even at the top who are missing out on critical opportunities. And I think that is what we're seeing in the US. We've seen it in the UK, where I currently live in London, with the Brexit vote, and we're seeing that continuing. So I think American Voices International, what we saw was all of us have been very politically involved from a partisan perspective, but we were finding that this partisanship in the US was causing more damage than good, and particularly to those 8.5 million Americans living overseas. And that's the non-military Americans living overseas. There's quite few of us living abroad, and we're often left out of the conversation. So several of us came together, we're in a very new organization, we're putting together a congressional advisory board across the aisle to make sure that those voices are heard. So I'm here in a Republican commentator capacity. I don't work with the Trump campaign. I have spoken to him, so I do have some insight for you if you have specific questions. But I want to give you kind of the Republican dilemma more than anything else, and kind of that battle we're having internally with ourselves and as a party. So just the context, we've gone through some of this already, but if you see where we are as far as the actual election process, is it working? In the land of the free and in the home of liberty, it's very depressing to see that 27% of Americans believe that the election process isn't working. And if you ask Donald Trump, he'll tell you it's rigged. So that's what he said recently. I think it does work. I think the Electoral College does have a purpose. When you look historically at the reasons for that, we have to remember our founding principles and going back to that. And I think that we've lost sight of some of those, which is part of the frustration within much of the electorate. The satisfaction of the American public with the government at the moment is very, very low. John McCain once said, we're down to basically our advisors and our family who approve of us. So I think we're very much in that case as well. And these are, I pulled these yesterday from Gallup, and this bar over all the way to the left is is quite telling of where we are, particularly that top number, that 9.7 real unemployment rate. This is why people are frustrated. People are frustrated that $4,000 off worse than they were before the recession. People have not seen the recovery that they were promised. They have not seen the hope and change that they were promised. This is why people across the board, not just Republicans, but Republicans, Democrats, independents, students, the middle class, small business owners. And I think that small business owner aspect is something that is a key voting block within this election. And that real unemployment rate, people who have left the workforce, people who are underemployed, is the kicker. They hear the government saying, we've added more jobs, we're doing great, we're having growth, but people aren't seeing it. And it comes down to politics is always local. And people are not seeing it locally. They're not seeing it at their homes. They're seeing that they're still having to cut back and still having trouble saving and sending their kids to college. Now, the bottom thing here, as of yesterday, the most recent poll, the Real Clear Politics poll aggregate is a great thing to keep track of. But this is something that came out yesterday. It's the LA Times poll that shows Clinton ahead by 1 point. And that's a national poll. Now, going back to that all politics is local, national polls are great, but what matters in the US election is state polls, and actually district polls. Because you have a situation where districts actually can swing an entire state. So I'm from Texas, and I'm from Houston, which is a heavily Democrat city, which people are very surprised to hear. And Houston has the ability to really push the state to the Democrat side if it wanted to. That's where a lot of big Democrat fundraising is done, is in Texas, and people are often surprised to hear that. It's turning very much into what we would call the purple state. So it's becoming much more Democrat than it used to be. I get asked a lot about the state of the party. Is it falling apart? What's going to happen if Trump wins? What's going to happen if Trump loses? And I think there's some interesting things. The party, we have to separate the party from the candidate. And the way that our system works is that you have the party, so the Republican National Committee, which is actually made up of people who kind of came up through the system, if you will. They were volunteers, they were stuffing envelopes, they got involved at a local level, they were doing fundraising, and that's how it's come through. They're not elected officials like in a parliamentary system where the leader of your party is the prime minister or is an elected official. The leader of our party is basically a campaign and fundraiser. But the state of the party right now is stronger than it's ever been. We have the Republican Party has 31 governors. They hold the majority of the state house and legislatures across the country. They have the majority of the House of Representatives. They have the majority of the Senate. They're doing very well in voter registration, particularly in the swing states. So this lists Colorado, Florida, Iowa, Nevada, New Hampshire, North Carolina, and Pennsylvania. Those are the states to watch for the election. And I was talking to somebody in the Trump campaign yesterday, and she said in Massachusetts, they've had 22,000 conversions from Democrat to Republican in registered voters. So if that's happening in Massachusetts, where I used to live, and I was one of maybe five names on the Republican roll when I go to vote, that's telling you quite a lot to this story. But talking about the money, U.S. elections are unbelievably expensive, and I would agree with Bernie Sanders that there needs to be some real reform in that. Because in the election last time, Romney's spending was $885 million. Obama's was $919 million. That's the budget of most of the countries that I work in. So Trump has just in August raised $90 million, and of that is $70 million in small donations, which means those people can donate again, and again, and again, up until the personal limit that you have. So that's quite telling. And then talking to my friend in the campaign, she said, in August, they were really nervous, but now they're very positive and quite thinking that they have a very good chance of winning because they have momentum. And they said, that's something that Hillary doesn't have, that they have momentum to move them in into the debates, and if he does well in the debates, to carry him through to November 8th. So, how did we get here? I asked myself that a lot. So, this election is an election of the people versus the party. It is not your traditional election that we've had, where you have somebody who's been groomed for 4 or 8 years coming in and taking the nomination, or somebody that's kind of an incumbent. Hillary's seen as the incumbent in this election, and we'll come back to that in a bit. As it was mentioned earlier, Jeb was what the establishment wanted. The GOP wanted Jeb. Actually, they wanted Scott Walker. If you talk to the people at GOP headquarters, they all come from the same place. They all come from Wisconsin. But Scott did not perform very well. And so the money was behind Jeb. And the momentum within the big fundraiser, within the big dollar donors, was behind Jeb. And they thought, for sure, this is a much more centrist candidate that can come in. He can take some votes away from Hillary. And that this is who we need, kind of Mitt Romney, but appeals to the base. But they were unbelievably wrong and had misjudged how frustrated the public was, but also how much they had alienated those small money donors. And I blame the party a lot for how this has actually moved along, because their arrogance within the GOP party leadership, so those kind of fundraisers and campaigners, had been such that they believed that it was, we can raise more money, we can outspend, and we can win. And that's not always the way that it actually works. So there was that issue. There was the frustration of the people. And Trump has really been able to tap into that. I'm talking to the campaign, they've talked about, she said, you know, we sit down as his advisors, we talk to him, and he asks all these questions, he's very inquisitive. She worked, my friend worked in the Reagan administration, and she said, you know, he reminds me of Reagan. I said, really? And she said, he does. He does, because he's a big picture person, and he has the big ideas, and he wants to put the teams together to make it happen. Now, she put it very eloquently, and I asked her, I said, so why can't he do that? Why can he not say this as well as you have? And she said, well, he's learning. He's learning that he's not a politician, and he's learning that politicians have to be a bit more measured in the way that they speak. So we'll see what happens come September 26th in the first debate. The thing that I found really interesting throughout this whole journey in the primary season was that as people dropped out, there were no endorsements. As Mitt Romney came out and said, we can't vote for Trump, we need to have a much more measured, kind of steady hand at the till. I found this unbelievable that nobody was actually endorsing. They were hedging their bets. They didn't want to back a loser. And I also feel that some of our greatest talent that we have in the party, people such as Paul Ryan, Nikki Haley, the governor of South Carolina, people of that ilk have stepped back and they've said, ooh, this is going to be too messy of a campaign, the job's too big, chances are somebody's going to be a one-term president, I don't want to be a one-term president, I'm going to step back. Now personally, I find that a bit sad, that they're afraid to actually step into that leadership role, because that's what a leader does. And I think that the party has been a bit afraid to actually move forward with the right type of candidate. So I think a lot of those different things played into Trump's hands. And Trump has been able to use his machine to actually get the numbers, get that data, aggregate that data, understand the behavioral side of the voting population, and understand what makes them tick, what makes them frustrated. And what he's done is built his messaging around that, and he's done it without a filter, which is what everybody is very frustrated with the polished politician. And they said, you know what, he says it like it is, he says the things that I'm frustrated about, and he does it without the worry of political correctness. And that's something that has played very well across the country, and across generations, and across political divides as well. So, with this, the other thing from a Republican perspective, when I worked with Tom DeLay, who was my congressman in Texas, we had a meeting one day and he said, look, this was in 2004 before Bush's second term, and he said, it's great to win the presidency, that's always a bonus, but we have to win the House and the Senate. And if the Republican Party takes their eye off the ball, which is kind of what's been happening, and this is what Ted Cruz was alluding to when he was booed at the convention, that you have to have the House and the Senate. That's where the real power is. That's where the policy is really made. And the president is there to be a leader to help steer that. But If the Republicans are not careful, what will happen is that they will lose the House, they will lose the Senate, and they'll lose the presidency, and they'll be out in the desert for who knows how long. But this year is different. And you have the anti-movement, in some cases the anti-anti-movement. Most people who are supporting Hillary or Trump are doing so because they're not supporting the other one, or they're not the other one. And speaking to some pollsters I know back in the States, they were saying this is the first time they can remember that the most disliked candidates on either side became the front runners and are now the candidates for president. And you have Hillary Clinton reaching out to Republican voters. And you have President Obama invoking the words of Reagan and even Bush in some of his speeches, and saying this is not the party of Lincoln. But then you have, and you also have Hillary running the Republicans Against Trump website, which I just thought was kind of funny. But they're really trying to pull that other side over. And the other night they did interviews on NBC, one of the major stations in the US, 30-minute interviews, both of them. And they spent a large amount of their time talking about how they're not the other candidate. So that's what this election really comes down to. It's people voting against the other candidate, not voting for a candidate. The millennials are something that's talked about quite a bit, and they're really a vote that's in play. You saw a lot of them rallying behind Bernie Sanders. You see Hillary having trouble with them. You saw a lot of the Republican candidates having trouble appealing to them. A lot of them were looking at Marco Rubio as their potential candidate of choice. Within the Republican Party, but you do see a lot of them supporting Trump. And one of the reasons that you see that is because he's not the establishment, he's something different, he's not more of the same. And that's where Hillary is seen as very much the incumbent candidate, which the incumbent is normally a good thing to be, because people say, well, at least we know what we're getting. But this time people say, we know what we're getting and we don't like it. And that's a real problem. And with Trump, people say, he's untested, we don't know what we're getting. But why not? Let's try something different. What's the worst that could happen? Potentially a lot, but we never know. And so what Trump has been doing has been going out there and saying less about the kind of details of his policies and more about why Hillary shouldn't be elected. And this is why people are voting for Trump and not for Hillary. So when I talk to people back in Texas who actually despised Trump during the primaries, and now I speak to them, and the most ardent supporters of him, I said, well, how can you be supporting Trump now? And they said, well, he's not Hillary, and I'm not going to be remotely responsible for putting her into the White House. And it's because people don't trust her. They don't trust her, they think that she has continually lied, and it's not the big lies, it's the little lies, it's the little stories, it's the fibs, it's the disingenuous nature that they see. And this issue of her emails will continue to haunt her throughout the election. The story that came out this week about the 13 different devices, some of which were smashed with hammers to delete the data, will continue to follow her throughout the campaign. Some of the RNC speaking notes that I get, they were saying that, you know, something that they calculated was 321 times did Hillary and her advisors say, I don't recall, I don't remember about her emails. And that's becoming the story. And that's what Donald Trump has been doing. He's been managing the media and the story. In March, he had $8 billion worth of free media. $8 billion, more than any other candidate. Because, as they were saying earlier, he puts out a tweet, it becomes a story, he moves the story onto himself. And that's what he's been a master of that throughout this. And if he keeps the heat on Hillary, on Benghazi, on the emails, on the Clinton Foundation, then he will do very well moving into November. I also get asked quite a bit about why there was no kind of savior candidate that came in, no independent. And a lot of that has to do with the system. It's very difficult to do it, the amount of money that they would have to raise, logistics of getting on the ballots. But there's also the fear of taking the votes away and potentially putting the candidate that they would least like to see into the office. But this year we do have Gary Johnson, the Libertarian candidate, the former Republican governor of New Mexico, and his running mate, the former Republican governor of Massachusetts, and they're running as a Libertarian candidate. And then you have Jill Stein as the Green Party. Now, historically, the third parties have never really taken, made much of an effect. And with the Electoral College, with the winner-takes-all system, it's very difficult for them to have an overall effect. Ross Perot in 92 took 19% of the vote. I would think, because speaking to people that are within my generation, kind of Generation X, late 30s, early 40s, they're very torn as to how they're going to vote, including myself. And they say, well, I don't like either of them, and my philosophical viewpoint is I can't vote for either one of them. So what I want to do is actually send a message to my party, and I'm going to vote Libertarian, or I'm going to vote Green. And I think you will see a much higher percentage given to the Libertarian candidate this time around, because that, and the way that they've been campaigning has been very much through social media. And if that happens, a lot of people that I know in the Trump campaign and the Hillary campaign as well say, oh, but it's a waste of vote if you vote for the Libertarian or the Green Party. Well, I would beg to differ, because I think what happens is when you do that, you actually force a change. And I've seen it, I've worked in British politics, and what we saw there was that even with one Green MP in the House of Commons, the Conservative Party was forced to take more Green issues on board. And so you can move a party through having an effect through those fringe or third party votes. So that's a space to watch. And just interestingly, if Gary Johnson takes one state, which is highly unlikely, but if he does, it gets thrown into the House of Representatives most likely, and then all bets are off as to what happens. Now, if you watch Veep, if any of you watch on HBO, that's what happened there. So we're all waiting to find out what happens. But I think regardless of who's elected, whether it's Trump or Clinton, they have a real challenge, and there has to be real, tangible change to people at home. They have to feel it in their pocketbooks. They don't want to see health premiums rising. They don't want to see their income stagnated. They don't want to see their children not being able to go to college. There has to be a real tangible change. And if that doesn't happen, they're a one-term president regardless of who they are. So the first presidential debate is September 26th. It's going to be quite a spectacle. And it'll be interesting to see what happens. And I think from that, we'll actually get a very good feel of particularly where Trump is, because we'll have to say some specifics on his policies, but we'll get an idea of what the tenor of the campaigns will be moving forward. So I will let you ask some, I will let you ask a few questions, and then I do have to jet off, so I'm sorry. Thanks.
Yeah, I have a question about the media responsibility for where we are today. I'm just curious, a couple of you mentioned the fact that, and I think this would be for the benefit of the European audience, you know, there were 16 nominee candidates for the Republican Party, which divided the field tremendously in those early primary days. And to the extent that Trump was winning those primaries, never winning really a majority of the primary vote, and then the reference to the tweets and the fact that he was able to drive the media message. I mean, how responsible were the journalists involved in covering this campaign for, in a sense, giving him that primacy, you know, taking the bait, so to speak, and not only having a distorting effect on the Republican side, but also on the Democratic side? Because let's not forget that Bernie Sanders is just as much, in many ways, as a phenomenon as Donald Trump. But the attention that Trump attracted and continues to attract must have had an impact on the kind of media that that Bernie was getting. I mean, I was very frustrated myself watching it because, I will endorse what the second speaker said. I'm sorry if I can't remember your name. To hear the word socialism. I mean, we were watching the debate and I kind of jumped out of my chair and I said, it's not that I'm a socialist, but it's so refreshing to hear capitalism and socialism actually debated. So, but you know, very, very quickly, that media machine just took on the Trump obsession, and we lost any kind of objective coverage, in a sense, I think, in those early days.
Okay, how much do you take on that in a second, and on this question here?
America has a love affair with reality TV, sensationalism, and anything from you can get a huge number of people out for and start loving it when someone gets killed. You can see a lot of people cheering football when people play not according to the rules. Is it possible that Trump's appeal is symptomatic of a serious illness in the American culture that turns away from the moral high ground of someone like Bernie and turns to a reality TV moral reprobate?
I don't think it's necessarily a turn from the moral side of things. I think what he's done is just tapped into the frustration, which is why he's been so successful. Because particularly with the Republican field, none of them were able to do it quite to the same degree. I think the one who was maybe closest were maybe Rubio and Cruz. Their style was very different. I was a Rubio supporter because I felt he was the candidate that we needed, not necessarily because he was the best candidate. But I felt that he was somebody who could actually move us forward. I heard him talking about the future, and we need to plan for America 50 years from now instead of where we are now. But he was, the way that he was handled by his team didn't allow him to be as personable or kind of loose in his responses. Now with the media, I think there's a few things with this. One of the things is Trump has always been a media darling, so to speak. He knows everybody who's talking about him, he knows him personally. And that's one of the things that you hear in a lot of the commentary, whether it's on CNN, NBC, MSNBC, Fox News, wherever. Well, the Donald Trump I know doesn't say this. And he's not like that. He doesn't think this. And so there's a personal relationship that they have already built in that they're going to want to cover. But covering an economic speech is not very exciting. And so, but covering Trump out on the stump saying something quite controversial and telling a woman with a crying baby to leave is very exciting, and that's news now. And when I watch campaigns, media coverage, say in the UK, where they have very strict laws about impartiality and balance of point of views, you get a very different delivery on that. Whereas in the US, it's not really until the general election that we have any sort of impartiality that's required. So when you have a field of 15 candidates, it comes down to money, it comes down to existing relationships, and it comes down to being provocative. And I think that that's what Trump has done, and has been a master of that throughout the campaign.
Thank you for coming and giving us this particular speech. Couldn't also avail of the opportunity to get his informed, skeptical maybe, and hopefully entertaining take on the presidential election campaign. Kevin Cullen.
Thanks for having me. It's wonderful to be here.
How did Donald Trump get to the point that he could conceivably become the leader of the free world? Well, he began by insulting all Mexicans, calling them rapists and drug dealers. He belittled a war hero who had been the Republican nominee for president in 2008. He sneered at the physical appearance of the only woman running for the Republican nomination. He suggested a woman journalist who posed that question was a menstrual. He mocked the disability of another journalist. He made repeated references to the size of his penis. He believes in the use of torture. He advocates killing the families of terrorists. He called for barring people from the United States based on their religion. He smeared the mother of an American soldier who was killed in combat. He called on a hostile foreign government to commit espionage against American interests. He speaks glowingly of Vladimir Putin, suggested Putin is a far better leader than President Obama. He has encouraged his supporters to beat up those who oppose him and has volunteered to pay their legal fees if anyone is arrested for committing violence. He has suggested that gun owners would have to take matters into their own hands if Hillary Clinton is elected. He has said if he loses, the election will have been rigged. I could go on, but you get the picture. Donald Trump became the Republican nominee for president by saying things that in a previous campaign cycle would have ended a campaign. The more outrageous things he says, the more publicity he gets, the more those who support him cheer him on. He is the anti-politician in an era when many Americans dislike nothing more than politicians. People in my business have spent countless hours trying to dismiss him, believing that eventually Trump would go too far, would say something that, as O'Casey might have said, was beyond the beyonds. But I don't believe there is anything that Trump could do or say that would dissuade those who are prepared to vote for him. He said it himself, he could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue and the people that support him would still vote for him. His vulgarity is seen as candor by those who support him, his bombast seen as confidence. His open contempt for groups of people, by any objective measure, the definition of naked prejudice, is admired by those who sneer at what they call political correctness and what used to be known as basic civility. His lack of knowledge about basic foreign policy is seen by his supporters as evidence that he won't launch foreign adventures. His insistence that he will build a wall along the Mexican border resonates with many Americans who think immigration is out of control. I've spent the last few months particularly asking friends and acquaintances and total strangers why they would vote for Trump. A large number, I'd say the vast majority, in fact, say they are voting for Trump because they don't like Hillary. You cannot explain the phenomenon that is Donald Trump without acknowledging how deeply unpopular Hillary Clinton is with most Americans. The good news for her is that the only politician more unpopular, more disliked than her, is Donald Trump. This is the first presidential election in which both the Republican and Democratic nominees are disliked by a majority of Americans. By any objective standard, Hillary Clinton is more suited to be president. As Secretary of State, she has been in the situation. She knows how government works. She is, for all her faults, all her flaws, an intelligent, competent politician. But in this most unusual election cycle, being a politician, being someone with a record, is perhaps the biggest handicap. Americans are deeply cynical about Washington, seeing politicians as mainly interested in benefiting only themselves. The hyper-partisanship that has led to so little getting done in Washington over these most recent years has made the rise of the anti-politician possible. Trump's lack of specifics, his policy-free speeches, sound authentic to his supporters, as much as they sound ridiculous to those of us who think Trump is spectacularly unqualified to be president. Donald Trump has confounded all of his critics because he is running a campaign that thumbs its nose at accepted wisdom. He does not have an army of advisors and strategists. He has eschewed TV ads. He refuses to release his tax returns. He has no real ground game, certainly compared to Clinton. He has basically been winging it, making it up as he goes along. His insistence on doing things his way without a filter is usually political suicide. But there is nothing usual about this election. There is a deep unease in America, and not just among conservatives who fear outsiders in the outside world. Bernie Sanders, an avowed socialist, did far better than the so-called experts expected. Americans whose wages are stagnant, who've worked more than one job, who are part of the first generation that won't do better than their parents, they want change as much as Trump supporters aspire to that place where America supposedly would be great again. The polls suggest this race is closer than expected. In fact, I think the polls are underestimating Trump's popularity. As we saw with Brexit, there is a reluctance among some people to tell pollsters that they're with Trump. But many mainstream Republicans have been willing to say publicly that they won't vote for Trump. Massachusetts Governor Charlie Baker is one of them. Ohio Governor John Kasich, one of the last Republican candidates vanquished by Trump, has refused to help Trump win Ohio. And if Trump doesn't win Ohio, he doesn't win the presidency. The Dallas Morning News the other day refused to endorse Trump. For the first time in 75 years, they endorsed a Democrat. Again, the open contempt that so many establishment Republicans have for Trump only boosts his reputation with those who support him and who dismiss reasonable Republicans as rhinos, Republicans in name only. I don't think Trump will win, but I think he could win. And I wish I didn't think that.
We have some of the portable mics for the speakers, and maybe if we could turn up the house lights and turn down the spots when you get a chance. And there were a couple of questions, and I'll take them, and then I want to roll in as well, especially that David asked by the media to these speakers also. Martin, stand up and use your best court voice.
Thank you very much. As I said earlier on, the real power in the US system is in the House and in the Senate and in the gubernatorial election. What's the panel's view on how they're going to pan out? Because ultimately, even if there is a Trump presidency, it's going to be hamstrung by what happens in both the Senate and in the House.
Okay, I'll take another one. Malcolm, in your best counsel voice.
First of all, I would like to compliment you. And this point about the views of experts. And people will be aware that during the course of the Brexit debate, Michael Gove, the British minister, famously said, we've had enough of experts. And is there this danger, and it ties into the digital media point. I actually think you mentioned socialism, so why not mention the great socialist Karl Marx? I think Marx was right. Marx famously said that the revolution will come when the tools of production are in the hands of the proletariat. And with new media such as Twitter, you know, the tools of production are in the hands of the proletariat. Facts don't matter anymore. If you have an opinion, if you have a feeling, and Gingrich has kind of expressed that, we can see it in the Netherlands with their vendors, facts don't matter anymore. So how do we as the political establishment kind of reconnect with those who feel that they are alienated? And one just brief comment on Larry Donnelly and his titles. Larry Donnelly, I'm interested in his bio, described himself, and reinforced my point, as a political commentator on the journal.ie. The problem is in the new world, everybody is a political commentator.
Okay, let's roll some of those together. We'll start with Pat and walk down. First, this question about we're in a post-fact era, and David's point that the media have sat out this. I mean, you can be impartial, and you can, in this part of the world, media legally have to not be biased. But there's no bias in the facts, whether true or false. There's no neutrality about the facts. Has that been an issue this campaign?
Well, I believe the media is just now trying to figure out how to cover politics in America in the age of social media. Okay, I think things are fun. The ground is shifting underneath everyone. And no one, I think, in the media, I think the entire media hasn't quite figured it out yet. I think piece by piece they are figuring it out. I think the Dallas Morning News figured it out, okay? And they decided they had a responsibility to stand up, to speak out, and they did so boldly. You know, the other media, the media in America, I believe, most of them, they want to be fair and even-handed. And there's a lot of really good journalists around the country who believe in that. When I worked so much outside the United States, when I started going to Latin America and arriving there and trying to figure out how to do campaigns there, and the people I would work with say, okay, well, that's our newspaper, and that's our radio station, that's our television station, so we're going to go and talk to them. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. You've got your own, What's happening in America now is you have, I think, a lot of very good, responsible, fair journalists who live in a media culture which is getting more like Latin America than the United States of America, okay? They're beginning to criticize Fox News, led the way on this. Other cable outlets are also, you know, MSNBC is much more to the left, Fox News is moving to the right. So our media culture is changing, and in the midst of that, there's this whole new way for candidates and campaigns to bypass the media culture, okay? So the rules, I think, they're trying to figure out on the fly. I don't know if they're gonna figure them out by election day, okay, in 2016. But I do think that the aftermath of this election, depending on the result, will reshape the media environment in America. And the media environment right now is being driven for the most part by revenue, which there is a lot of, particularly on the television side, and by the ability to move the course of events by the way that you cover things. Normally, a candidate like Trump who's been getting very tough coverage, for example, from the New York Times, would not have survived that coverage. But Trump is able to bypass that coverage and talk directly to voters, principally through social media. So we'll see what happens in this election. The outcome, I think, will determine whether that media changes.
Okay, Larry?
Yeah, I have kind of a slightly cynical or even a flippant take on the media issue, and that is, the media wouldn't continue. Remember, this campaign goes on forever. American campaigns go on forever. The media wouldn't be giving the Trump as much coverage as he gets if people weren't reading, clicking, watching, etc. Trump fascinates people. They go to these stories because they want to read them. You mentioned the journal.ie. In terms of the columns I've written on American politics, there's almost double the people read the columns that have Trump in the title versus the ones that don't. So to some extent, the media is only a reflection of what we're seeing, of what's there and what's in the public. So yeah, there's certainly an issue there about media coverage of politics. And I think, again, Tad makes the case very well that social media kind of effectively bypasses in some of the old organs, both at national and local level. For instance, Kevin's paper, The Boston Globe, it doesn't have the same impact that it once did. But the landscape is transformed. So the bottom line is, if the media is only, I think, to some extent, a reflection of what's out there.
Okay. But I mean, if Donald Trump can send a message directly to 11.9 million people, and nobody is mediating him, saying, that's true, that's not true, that's nonsense, that's not factual, is that part of the problem?
Well, what I would say is that certainly a platform like Twitter allows Trump, but also Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders, all of Trump's opponents. But in the same way that view, if they're at all critical of them. And so
bring the microphone here, but before we take the question, Pat and Larry, maybe Martin's question about the Congress, the House and the Senate. I mean, Stacy showed us the hold the Republican Party has. What has that on the governorships?
Well, listen, first of all, we draw a line between the House races and I think the Senate and the gubernatorial races. Okay, then you have the presidential campaign. The House races, in large measure, are dictated by the districts that have been designed by Republican control of governors and state legislatures. And they have gerrymandered, that's the term we use, these districts, and have given them tremendous advantage. And so unless there is a tidal wave of an election, and the electorate that turns out is so heavily Democrat, 8-9 points plus Democrat, the Republicans are in a very good position because of that tactical advantage to hold on to at least a majority of the House, not as big as they have right now, but to still hold on to the House. The Senate races, the gubernatorial races, they're different. They're like the presidential, the statewide races. So if the Democrat, if Hillary wins by any measure, a few points even, there's a very good chance the Democrats are going to take back the Senate. The governor's races will go up and down depending on the nature of the state. You know, if you've got a Republican governor, Charlie Baker, if he were running for re-election, would re-elect in Massachusetts. Very liberal state because, you know, he's in sync with the voters there. So it will depend on the individual. So we'll have to wait and see. The only way the Democrats take the House and the Senate and the presidency is, I think, a massive tidal wave election. So right now, I think, you know, they'll probably hold on to the House. I think we're going to get the Senate just because there's so many Republicans up, and it's likely to be, you know, better electorate for Democrats in general, and we'll have divided government, but, you know, we'll see how divided it is when it's over.
Unless you disagree with that, Larry, we'll take the next question.
Just a very quick postscript question, really, for Kevin. If the media have given a lot of coverage to both candidates, but I said sometimes that because she's the more responsible candidate, she gets more forensic an analysis of every single thing she does, Hillary Clinton, whereas Trump is more like the Michael O'Leary style of campaigning, it's just oxygen is going for. How come no journalist has found his tax returns?
Why no journalist has found, we can't get his, it's up to him to release his tax returns. But that is a campaign issue. I mean, there's obviously a belief that he's hiding something or he released them. But, I think your point is true about, I think Mrs. Clinton is held to a higher standard because, but it's hard to, there's such a lack of substance in what Trump has said. He's not really outlined a lot of policies. It's very broad stuff. And he always says, oh, I'll get to that after I get elected. And, you know, how do you respond to that? So, I mean, I think she is treated like a typical politician. And so, and she, like I said, she has a lot of faults, a lot of flaws. But Trump doesn't have a record. We can't point, we've pointed to his business record, which is spotty at best. We pointed to his, different things that have happened in his life and stuff, but he doesn't have a public record that he's running on. And it's very hard. So, I mean, in some respects, I think it is true that she's held to a higher standard than he is. But I don't think media can do anything more. I think everybody knows what Donald Trump is about. And, you know, the reality is there is a sizable number of Americans who are willing to take a chance with him.
Good question.
Yeah, I was wondering if the panel could comment on both candidates dealing with the huge global issue of radical Islam. And why Trump seems to be, ostensibly racist, but Hillary can't seem to make any serious comment.
Larry, will we start with you?
Sure. It's a complicated issue, obviously, and obviously Trump, with his attacks and with what Kevin was alluding to, proposing a ban on Muslims entering the country, that's quite a retrograde step, and obviously one that I think horrifies a lot of right-thinking people. At the same time, there is a palpable fear in the United States of terror since 9/11 and still the terrorists there, and something that, as somebody who lives outside the U.S., it's tough to kind of get to grips with at times. How you do it, how you come back on that, it's a difficult issue, but I think that that Hillary needs to, I suppose, be forthright in defending the principles that the country was based on, one of which is the free practice of religion, and I think distinguishing between, as you put it, radical Islam versus mainstream Islam, which millions of Americans practice.
Go ahead, question here in a minute.
Yeah, so,
Hillary
very recently described a section of Trump's supporter as a basket of deplorables. A basket of deplorables. Do you think, given the context of what we're talking about today, that she needs to take the gloves off and go after Trump a bit more? And will that help her, or will Trump turn it to his advantage?
Well, tell me that, and if you were debate predator, Harry first. You were Harry first, then Tad. And if you were debate predator, you must be sitting in rooms now trying to figure out how does she play this debate.
Just quickly, that was a very foolish thing for her to say, in my opinion. It's one thing to go after the candidate, but to go after the people who are voting for Trump. Again, a lot of these people are Americans who are hurting and who are desperate. To say that about them is a very, very big political misstep, in my view.
Yeah, I'm against attacking the voters, too. I think that's always a bad idea.
You know, I think Hillary Clinton and her campaign now need to work very hard to build up her favorables. Okay, I mean, they've spent $120 million on television advertising. They'll probably spend $200 or $300 million more between now and November. So far, it's been 100% negative. Now, Trump is a great target for negative ads. And trust me, I've made a lot of them in my day, and will continue to do so, and they're very effective. But sometimes you need to offer reassurance to voters. And I think with Hillary, it's very important in a lot of places in different media markets around the country in swing states to go in and to reassure people that they can be comfortable with her, that she is okay, that as president, they'll be comfortable with her leading the nation. So I would argue for, and if I were doing the debate prep.
Hater, you should turn up at the debate?
Well, no, listen, she first of all, she's gotta be true to herself, okay? And being authentic, you know, as to who you are, you can't change that. But for her to be comfortable in her own skin, to talk about things that she cares deeply about, to be positive and not just relentlessly negative against Trump. Paid media, you can make a choice, okay? If you want to understand a campaign strategy, look at their ads and look at where they're playing their ads. Okay, that is the objective manifestation of strategic intent, where you buy advertising and what it says, because you control it totally and it's driven by the information that you have in research. But I think these debates are going to be more important than any debate since 1960 in the United States. You know, because the voters are so skeptical about the process and about the media, frankly, that when the candidates stand on the stage, the voters are going to say, aha, forget the ads, forget the coverage, I can figure this one out for myself. And by the way, when I worked here in 2007 in Ireland, you know, I saw the same thing. Countries do not want to give any democratically elected government a third term. In America right now, they're looking at a fifth Clinton-Obama term, okay? I mean, that's effectively the way they see this thing, and they don't want to give it. That's the headwind she's against. So that debate for her is as important as the debate that Bertie Ahern had with Andy Kenny a week before the election. That one event that really changed the whole trajectory of the election and wound up with Fianna Fáil not only winning in 2007 against all odds, against every poll, but actually, believe it or not, winning 0.1% more of the first vote preferences than they did in a landslide in 2002. You know, that's how big this debate's going to be.
I know Stacy touched upon what's next now for the Republican Party post this election, but I'd like to kind of get the panel's take on that. Particularly given that there are some quite high-profile members of the Republican Party who have lent their support to Donald Trump, but who you can see now are kind of starting to plan beyond this election cycle. Paul Ryan, for example, you can see him starting to put the language out there in campaigning for the House and the Senate. Don't write Hillary Clinton a blank check. Don't let her have control of the House and the Senate, which is, interestingly enough, the exact same phrase they used in 96 for, they'd kind of given up on Bob Dole a few weeks out from the election and kind of started to say, don't let Bill Clinton, don't write him a blank check, don't let him have control of the House. So I'm wondering, based on that, maybe what the panel think about where next for the Republican Party.
Kevin, where the Republican Party, Trump wins, Trump loses?
Well, if Trump wins, I think one of the interesting things, you'll all these sort of mainstream, very senior, respected Republican strategists and or advisors, are they going to sit it out? Are they going to say, I want nothing to do with this fellow? Or do they say, I'm going to save the country and go to work for Donald Trump, if that's the way they can portray it? I think if Trump loses, I mean, you know, the Republican Party, there's been a fight for the Republican Party's soul going on really since Reagan left. And it's a fight that's accelerated this year dramatically. And mainstream Republicans are still trying to get their head around how Donald Trump has pulled this off. And I think that's going to continue no matter whether he wins or loses. I think that the Republicans are still in a very big identity crisis. And obviously, if he wins, I think a lot of people will probably check their so-called principles at the door and be able to say, well, I'm doing this for the country, not necessarily for Donald Trump. But there's an awful lot of talent that has worked, particularly in foreign policy, that wants nothing to do with this guy. So it'll be curious to see what happens if he wins.
Yeah, election years are, I suppose, time for voters to be able to reflect as well. And in that context, President Obama's approval ratings have gone way up. Do you think his legacy will be well remembered? You think perhaps his decency will be missed in contrast to the current spate of candidates? And is there a chance even that he may be remembered as a great president in times to come?
He'd be re-elected if he was on the ballot.
I think the interesting thing for me is the paradox in the polling right now. Because you have a very large percentage of Americans who say America is on the wrong track. On the other hand, the president has very high approval ratings, and the recent economic news is actually quite favorable. And so the paradox between that, I think, is quite interesting, and I think that the election is actually probably going to be the best barometer of where it is. There was a comment made earlier about whether or not what we were seeing with Trump represented some coarsening of American culture. On the flip side, the United States has twice elected an African-American president who, whether you agree with his policies or not, I think most people would say is somebody of eminent decency and has really administered a relatively scandal-free, very ethical administration. And so the same country that elected that president twice is now going to the ballot box in November. And it will be Dickensian, almost, in the tale of two elections, depending on how it goes. On the one hand, one result could be Trump. But the other tale of the city is that you could follow twice electing the first African-American president with electing the first woman president, and you could turn around and say, what a remarkable place that must be to have done that.
I think President Obama will be remembered as a great president. We were losing 800,000 jobs a month when he was inaugurated. You know, we were involved in two wars. There were 100,000 troops, American troops in Iraq, okay? You know, the president has, you know, by virtue of his leadership, I think, you know, and while there's still a serious economic problems, and Bernie Sanders certainly spoke to us in the campaign in the United States, we've had 65 months of continuous private sector economic growth in the United States. There are 13 million jobs that were created in that period of time. More Americans have health insurance now. They've taken the number of uninsured under 10% for the first time in history. You know, the president's, the actions that he's taken on climate change have been bold, and he's done it without any help from the Congress. Indeed, all of the action he took on that front was in resistance to the will of the Congress. You know, and I think he set an exemplar in terms of the way he and his family have lived their lives and represented our nation as the head of state. So yes, I think he will be remembered as a great president. However, history is written by the winners. And if Trump becomes the president, okay, then, you know, his legacy will be clouded by that fact, I think. So hopefully Hillary will be, and I think history will then come to recognize the incredible performance he had as president.
Very, very quick point. I just think one thing we haven't talked about much and hasn't been talked about in the United States much is African-American turnout. President Obama can play a very big role on that front, and it's vital for Hillary to be reelected if he's going to have a legacy.
Question here, and I'll take the next one there then.
Yeah, I think for many Americans that they feel that the two-party system has not served them well, and that I think that many of them actually believe that they become indistinguishable in terms of parties because they're basically both bought out. And this is one of the things that really have touched a nerve with a lot of people, a lot of Bernie supporters, is that now, you know, things are being basically run not by people, they're being bought out by money, basically.
I think the next question would have been, sorry, go ahead, yeah.
So I think one of the things is, like, even in terms of like the media and stuff, the distrust of the media, many voters view that as this is the all part of the oligarchy, that it's basically six media corporations out there and they're not reporting the news. They're actually trying to drive and make the news. They're not actually reporting the news properly. And one thing that if you talk to really strong Bernie Sanders supporters, they are not, many of them are not getting along, getting on board with Clinton because they do not believe that Bernie you know, lost the election fairly. And there was a major study that was actually done, I think it was by Stanford, that basically said that, you know, Bernie won the election, is what they were saying, because of all the vote rigging that was going on. And this is not being covered by the media at all. It's being covered in some places, and this isn't even just like a small organization that came out with this. This is actually a major organization that came out with it, a very legitimate one. And I think anyone who's been looking at voter fraud for a long period of time, and it's like the United States doesn't even want to talk about it. But the thing is that it has been going on for a long time.
We have the question.
Thank you.
We get the next one here. Tadbury is doing that. You're well positioned. Do you think, is it a myth that the Bernie voters won't turn out for Hillary?
Well, this is what the polling says. About 85% of them have already decided that they're going to support Hillary. There's about 15% that aren't. Are they going to vote for Trump? I think not. I think they're going to vote for Jill Stein, or I think they're going to vote for Gary Johnson, or they're going to go and vote for others, and they're not going to vote for anybody. So, you know, will many of the people that he registered turn out to vote? They may decide to stay home. So you know, that's where it is right now, at least in terms of the polling. I think they find Trump reprehensible. He stands for everything, against everything that Bernie stood for, fundamentally, with the exception of one or two issues. So I think they're going to, in the end, most of them, that's what all the polling says, wind up, you know, with her. And listen, I think Bernie looked at this decision the way Al Gore looked at the Supreme Court case in 2000, okay? I mean, Al Gore stood up and basically said, I'm walking away from the presidency after the Supreme Court returned its opinion. And I think he did it because he had great respect for the rule of law in the United States and made that decision to try to keep the United States and rule of law in place. And frankly, as someone who worked for him, I'm very proud of the decision he made, even though the consequences of it were that George Bush came in and all the things that came along with it were devastating for America and the world.
Last question.
Thank you. A thought struck me during the middle of Colin's seminar that society moving towards social media, etc., and if the debate is going poorly, a candidate could literally tweet middle live debate, and that becomes a story, and that could possibly how Trump could cover it if the debates are going poorly for him. And I could just ask each of the panelists to look into the magic ball and predict how the TV debates could go or what we can expect from them.
Okay, we've had a bit of a take on it, but the capacity. Social media and Twitter gives the candidates and their campaigns to interrupt the news cycle and put their, what they call a dead cat on the table or distraction technique.
Yeah, no, it's certainly the case. I mean, I would find it very hard to watch a debate on TV without my Twitter feed open. But the reality is that while the campaigns can, as you say, throw a dead cat in the middle of my Twitter timeline, the journalists are also commenting live during those proceedings as well. In fact, some of the best tweets I've seen have been the live tweeting by journalists during debates where they are putting the corrective into what the candidates are saying. There's also a very high snark coefficient that is employed by journalists as they banter back and forth with each other, stuff that may not make it into their main pieces, but is certainly prevalent during the course of the debate. The reality is that you can always, there was a philosopher who said that a great truth is a truth whose opposite is also a great truth. And the great truth of the internet, and social media in particular, is that falsehoods can spread very quickly. But the opposite is also a great truth, which is that the corrective can also spread very quickly as well. And so you can also remedy something that's problematic with instantaneously almost.
As well as being a nice historic cinema, this venue doubles as a full-scale digital cinema. So I think what Tomas should do is operate, arrange a pajama party on the night of the 26th of September. It's 2 o'clock our time. Put out the popcorn, I suspect the house will be full of popcorn. Yeah, great. Folks, I told you this would be the most interesting session, and it has been. I want to talk to Tad, Larry, Colin, and Kevin. Can you please give them a big round? Boston Globe's investigation in the clerical abuse in the Boston Diocese is an extraordinary story. Spotlight is an extraordinary film.